Everyone to the Archon Team League Championships. I am Noxious. I'll be your host for the day. We're on to phase two of the whole thing. Casting with me today is going to be Amaz. How are you doing, sir?
Oh man, this is going to be so exciting. I had a great stream just now, but this is really the highlight of today, right? We're going to see Tempestorm facing off against Nihilim first, and this is the winner's match, which we're going to have the good news first. One team is going to advance to the finale directly, which is going to be at September 11th to 13th in the Archon Team House, of course. And then we have a little bit of bad news later on with Forsen Boys versus Archon. Both of them will not make it to finale, and one of them will have their dreams pretty much crushed.
Yeah, so I have a question for you because I had to catch up on this. The whole format doesn't allow the players to switch their decks at this point, right? Or so, can they switch between yesterday and today?
So yeah, in phase two, none of the decks can be changed. All right. And it was pretty cool because we didn't know. When I typed the rules out in June or something, because it was really early on, right? The league started in July. I did not know when TUT was actually going to be announced, right? And it happened to land right before phase two. So that was actually pretty brutal, where if they actually came up with a bad deck, well, they have to stick with it until the end of phase two. So
yeah, we saw Sixo have a little bit of a tough run with his secret deck. We're hoping it's going to go better for him, you know, when he faces off against Force and Boys. You know, it's been a pretty rough streak for him.
I mean, we do see some weird decks too, right? I mean, we have Temple Storm's Eloise bring the Fist of Jiraxxus deck, right? I mean, if that doesn't work well, you can't change it up. And of course, sometimes when you play a new deck, you go like, oh, what if I made this modification? It'll make the deck so much better.
But yeah. You can't do it. Yeah, exactly. So if it didn't turn out to work out in the past few days, and it's not going to work today. Now, the first match we're going to have is Tempestorm versus Nihilim. Now, before we move on, a quick shout out to all the sponsors. We've got the partnership with Alpha Draft. If you guys want to check them out, you can check them out at alphadraft.com, Esports Fantasy League. You know, they give away $300,000 in prizes each week. So for a share of that, you can subscribe over there. And Amazon App Store is also doing a promotion for Hearthstone card packs. You can check them out for a chance to get a 50% discount on 40 card packs. You can check them out on teamarchon.com/Amazon or amazon.com/Hearthstone. Now, I think we have a recap video to actually show what the people who might need a little bit of a follow-up before we move onwards to the gameplay. Right. So you guys can watch that. We'll be right back to hop into the action. Don't go anywhere. Enjoy the video. He was pretty focused.
Yeah.
Attacking to something might matter. And turns out he just wants to go face and is that. Oh my god, the blowout.
Oh, so well. He played it. Yeah. We saw that win condition before him anymore. And he missed.
He's like out of steam. And he has Hellfire heal buff next turn.
Oh,
wow. Oh my god, the top decks are real.
Look at that, RD.
This is a silly day.
Yeah. This is crazy. This is just, I don't know.
Like, can we get like Shia LaBeouf on a green screen saying that? And
front.
Whoa. Oh, there it is. There's the reaction.
You're right. That could actually.
Oh, so he's hoping for the concede. He's agonizing Trump. Well played. Well played.
Yeah, like you are.
That's it.
And Giara's gonna concede it, and Value
Triple Bench
goes for the crazy reverse sweep. Alex has to die.
No way.
We already saw one Doomsayer today. Not possible.
Okay. Oh my god!
Is it not?
It's just barely short, right?
Oh my gosh.
Oh my
what
god.
That's gotta be hard for me.
Oh, no matter what. The thing is, if the Doomguard comes out, you're forcing Shadow of Death, in which case Cabal is a bit less.
Which is fine.
It's a bit of a misplay. Yeah. Miss one damage. You could have traded Abusive first, but he's trading anyway.
Yeah, you got it.
Actually, no, he healed a minion, so if it hit for 6.
Ooh!
Oh, wait,
wait, wait! Oh, no, he's one off!
Oh, no. Oh, and that one missed damage actually hot cost him the game.
Yeah. All right, so we saw a few highlights of the entire Archon Team League, you know, all those grim patron lethals. I think we had quite a few of those with the massive OTKs. I think that's pretty standard. So we're going to move on to Temple Storm versus Nihilum. So I'm expecting some standard lists. You know, we saw the decks already for some of those players. There's really nothing out of the ordinary just yet, even after TGT, because if you look at all the cards that were released, there are probably some sleeping decks out there, right? Like, we're so close after the release that it's going to be really hard for all the players to have theory crafted everything to the maximum. So we're still in the learning phase, and they're not going to be too adventurous in a format like the Archon Team League, hopefully, because if the deck doesn't work, as you said, I mean, that's $250,000, potentially, that you're kind of losing out on, right?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, at the end, you can't really blame the players for bringing Patron Warrior. I mean, it's tried, it's tested, it's just optimized so well, like you said. And this is one of the biggest tournaments, if not the biggest tournament, right? It shares the prize pool of BlizzCon. And bringing home not only the prize pool, but the title is definitely like a big achievement for 2015. So, Yeah, just go with what you know. And well, we did see one deck that got pretty punished yesterday with the 6-0 Paladin secret list. But he did misplay a little bit. If he actually played, you know, the Blessing correctly on the mini bot, maybe things would have been different. But who knows? Right now, we will see one team go through the finale with Temple Storm and Nihilum. These are 6 games that they definitely want to win.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
I want to say there's got to be something about Nihilum because they were at the top of the brackets for the entirety of Archon Team League, pretty much. Right?
Yeah.
And then suddenly in the last 2 weeks, the worst case scenarios happened back to back. Like, nothing could have gone worse for them. They ended in the redemption phase. They got out of it. Now they're in the winner's game. So if they're able to make it today, at least they're going to feel pretty satisfied because it almost looked like the tournament might have been stolen, you know, from under their feet just about a week ago.
Yeah, it's actually a roller coaster ride for Nihilum, right? I actually, in the last week, if they actually won their game, they would have been first place, but they lost their game and they went to sixth place. So looking back at phase one, it's actually so important for each team to play their matches, like, super importantly, right? Because every match does count.
Yeah.
Temple Storm, on the other hand, they actually did really poorly at the start, and then they did really well. And they actually managed to finish in the 3rd to 5th place there. So that's pretty cool as well. It's just phase one is pretty wild now that I look back at it. It's just you think that the matches don't really matter, right? It's just 7 weeks of like scrimming.
Yeah, but it's absolutely false. Seeds. Like it's
yeah, exactly. Right.
I just wonder though, like, because right now we're still, you know, very early after TGT, you know, in the latest phases of the event, well, the last phase, of course, the finale, if people will have brought new decks, because there's quite a long time between right now and the finale, they've got about 2 weeks, I think, to start theory crafting and polishing some of their potential new ideas. And there's a lot of them out there. You know, people have come up with about 100 different decks. They have to trim them, you know, make sure that the unnecessary cards are, you know, removed and some of the better ones are included, modifications to existing ideas. You know, are some decks simply going to be phased out? You know, some of the decks that we already know just completely replaced as a result of TGT. And players have a lot of work to do, and the teams aren't exactly huge. Like, you have teams with a few players having to go through all this process within 2 weeks for the grand finals. I'm pretty excited to see how that's going to happen.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be a mess of, you know, figuring out the right decks to bring. I mean, you do have your core sets, right? I mean, right now, it seems like Hunter, Warrior, those are always going to be brought. But
right,
the other ones are just a mess. Like, Mage is, oh, sure, Freeze Mage is, like, really strong in this format. But then, is Temple Mage just better in a lot of matchups? And are players just going to bring 6 decks to counter Freeze Mage? You know, 6 very fast, aggressive decks or, Control Warrior instead of Patron. And Patron Warrior does deal pretty good with Freeze Mage as well. So I'm pretty sure that some decks will remain about and around. You know, you're always going to see that Zoo deck. You're always going to see that, you know, random Priest deck.
Right.
But who knows what the best one is.
Yeah, well, speaking of Freeze Mage, I think Thais possibly is bringing it, right? Like, I'm not entirely sure if that's the list he's running. I just never have seen Thais play anything but Freeze, and he plays it very well. I was listening to him recently speaking about Freeze Mage, and some people have been mentioning Malygos, right? How to include Malygos in Freeze Mage as an additional win condition, and Thais actually dislikes it a lot. He doesn't see the point of bringing Malygos if you can just play Pyroblast.
Yeah, it seems like Malygos is only a tech card against certain matchups. I mean, if you play Malygos against a Freeze Mage, that's insane. They don't have removal.
Right.
So 412 just sits there and you basically win the game. Another good matchup would be like, you know, either Control Warrior or Patron Warrior, where usually you kind of run out of damage and you run out of steam. And with Malygos, you can actually have that. Not only do you have like enough damage to kill them off, you also have that third minion where they only run two executes, right? So Antonitis, Alexstrasza, they usually die. But then the Malygos, or at least another order of them, actually manages to stick around. But here we go. First game is going to be between Eloise on Paladin. And we know that Eloise is playing kind of like the Murloc.
Well, it's a mid-range Paladin that's a little bit more on the Zoo side. It feels like a Zoo deck sometimes when you see it come out on curve. Mm-hmm. And you're like, sometimes mid-range Paladin did that, right? Mid-range Paladin already had that Zoo feeling to it when you got Knife Juggler into Mini-Bot into Muster for Battle. And that was, like, those games sometimes you just couldn't take. But with a Murloc Knight, like, that card, a lot of people, when they looked at it, they said, oh, it's a Murloc deck card. No, it's not. It's everything but a Murloc deck card. It's perfect for any archetype for Paladins just because it's such high value on its own. It's Inspire spawn, you know, synergistic cards from a 1-1 to like a 2-5 that makes you draw cards. It's crazy.
Yeah, it is. And I don't think anybody rated Murloc Knight as their top 5 or top 10 card, right? I think it's like a sleeper. The best sleeper card in Paladin that nobody thought was going to be good. But here, Eloise actually decided to coin a Knife Juggler. You only really get countered by one card in Freeze Mage, and Thais is exactly that. And Thais is pretty much off to a very good start. Eloise also has an owl, though. That's going to be a very important factor in this matchup.
Yeah, the owl allowing you to, you know, counter the Doomsayers. Some people tend to use them on Mad Scientists, but it's very, unless you're going to push for lethal, you know, almost immediately, it's very often not worth it, especially as Paladin, because you're so reliant on getting that board and keeping it. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, you know, this is a situation where you want to use the Iron Beak, but you know it's a sacrifice in the future when you get your board frozen or removed.
Yeah, I mean, Eloise is going to use the owl immediately and deny some card draw. And Taj's hand looks really, really clunky. I think cycling the Stalnos would maybe a good thing.
Yeah, I think he'll see that. I mean, Thais is a very experienced Freeze Mage player. He knows when he's just got to push for cycle. Like, Stalnos isn't even that good for spell damage purposes. What makes it better in Thais's case is very often the fact that he's always running Cone of Cold. Not everybody runs it, but it's such a good card. And Thais always has the one in his deck.
Yeah, some players believe that Cone of Cold might be a bit too expensive. Mm-hmm. But then Thais thinks that an extra Frost Nova that costs a little bit more expensive might be very helpful in the mid game.
Now, do you go for that Cone of Cold play? Because you could kill the Shredder right now. Because she didn't kill the Thalnos, you're getting a kill in the Shredder if you want it.
Well, yeah, the game plan of Freeze Mage is just to stall as much as possible, right? So we could actually see a Cone of Cold and just Thais not killing the Shredder off, because if you kill the Shredder, it effectively gets unfrozen, right?
Yeah.
So, well, he's just going to
That's a pretty good
and just save his freeze for later. It's not too much pressure as well. It's only 4 power on the board.
Yeah, and that Murloc Knight, so people consider the Murloc Knight a 4-drop, but when you really think about it, you never played before 6. You almost never played before 6, unless you're 100% sure it's going to get off the effect, because otherwise it's just a bad spider tank. Well, it's not a bad one, but it's just a spider tank you're paying 1 mana extra for, so the threat of the extra 1-1s might be worth it.
But here is actually not that bad, because like actually demands a response. And Freeze Mage is kind of like one of the weirder decks where you don't really want to clear minions too much. But yeah, Atasha is going to be forced to clear off the Murloc Knight here. It's just representing too much of a board.
Yeah, well, it's the scariest card. It's the absolute scariest card, I think, in Paladin nowadays. And the worst part is you're afraid of it, and you're afraid of Quartermaster, and you're afraid of all the 1-1s. You're afraid of everything now in Paladin. Like, I'm afraid of every single card they play.
Oh, man.
Murloc Knight just scares me that much.
Paladin's definitely got some love. And like we said before, Taj is going to leave the Shredder frozen, so it can attack. If you attack, it does get unfrozen, in a sense.
Good pickup by Eloise there, though. Gonna wipe the board.
Yeah, unfortunately, he's not putting up any pressure, so it's not even that good. It's gonna be tough for Eloise in this game.
And Thais has another round of healing. He picks up the Alex already. Let's see what comes out of this. What if?
Just another 3-2. Now Thais actually pinged the Shredder off because he's going to use the Frost Nova Doomsayer next turn so that he can actually clear the board. If he didn't ping that, then, you know, there's like less options if Eloise decides to play another Death Rider, for example.
Yeah, and Eloise here killed the heal bot because she knows that if she doesn't, there's a chance that it smashes itself into Dr. Boom and then Flame Strike takes the board away. So Dr. Boom, she's hoping, is going to stick and deal some damage, but it's not looking very likely from Thais' perspective.
Wow, double heal bot, man. Thais is really respecting the aggro matchup.
Is Thais just not going to Nova?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, never mind.
He's gonna do it, he's gonna do it.
I was a bit curious.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, so ping the Boom bot here guarantees that... What does it guarantee? Okay, if he silences his own Dr. Boom at the Doomsayer, then at least you've got something removed.
Yeah, I guess you always just want to play the board. I mean, Alex Strauss is next turn anyways, right? So, might as well. This is the weirdest Alex Strauss I've seen. Yeah, no turn.
Right.
But that's the only play. Now, this is actually a very good Tuskar Jouster turn. Let's see if we can take it. There's only Titus. That's a really big card.
An Emperor, right? There's like two cards that are like... Oh, wow.
Just
what a
right.
Crazy outcome here. The two Mad Scientists had already been played. The Acolyte of Pain number one. There was like one card that lost the Joust. Oh, man. I just can't like that.
Mm-hmm.
Little unfortunate for him, but I guess that's what happens. I mean, the amount of healing that Paladin can put together if they want now is pretty insane. And for that, you know, to that effect, I have a question for you. Like, Tuskar Jouster versus Healbot. There's a debate about it, of course, you know, because they accomplish pretty much the same function. If you're going to run one of Healbot, will you run one of Jouster, even though you might win a lot less consistently because it's a 5-5?
Well, theoretically, it's actually an insane card, right? I mean, if you're against an aggro deck, usually you're facing against a lot of low-cost minions, and you're going to get the healing because Joust is going to have a larger chance. And against like a control deck, you want the 5-5 body more than you want the heal anyways, right?
Yeah.
So, theoretically, it should be really good, but sometimes you really need that clutch heal, and you don't get it. And you might be asking yourself, why didn't I play a heal bot?
All right, well, that's about... I think that's the general consensus.
All right. So, I still think Jessica Jouster is better than anti-Killbot overall, just because, like, you have, like, flexibility. The only flexibility cards right now, I compare it to, like, a Cruel Taskmaster, where you can actually enable more damage, or you can clear one health creature.
A 1-1, right.
Yeah. So, this is, like, another flex card, and those are always really, really strong.
I kind of like that. That's a great comparison. You can use it for two different purposes because there's no way you're going to go offensive with a heal bot.
Right.
So Eloise here probably thinks her board is forfeit. Like there's no way this board is going to stick. If everything's going to getting pinged, whatever she plays is likely to just get removed. And stealing that 1-8 isn't exactly a great plan, but it's better than nothing.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, you're not really scared of, you know, there's some tricky play with Sylvanas, and then if you freeze mage... plays a Doomsayer and fireballs your Sylvanas and takes it. It doesn't really matter now because Thais is only sitting at 4 cards. And he didn't even cycle last turn. So this is probably just like a dead hand.
Yeah, throw everything and hope it sticks.
Yep.
If it does, then great. If it doesn't, well, too bad.
Still looking really, really good for Eloise.
I think if Thais picks up an Arcane Intellect, this could turn around.
Yeah, anything that cycles would be good. Like even an Acolyte of Pain.
Yeah, anything that draws, basically. He's got 12 cards, so that's 3 cards left in his deck that can draw him. He's thinned, you know, secrets out with Mad Scientist. So it's a miracle that he hasn't picked up one of those cycle cards yet.
It is kind of crazy that the bottom 12 cards are like, what, double fireballs, double frost bolts.
Yeah, it's everything pyroclast. He's been looking for to finish the game, pretty much. Yeah.
That's just... Frost Nova here does heal you for, like, you know, effectively 13. So...
3 mana, heal 13. Not quite the healing wave, but hey, we're getting there. Oh man.
Yeah, this is tough. I guess you kind of want to deal with the board as well, so let's do that.
Oh,
oh wow.
That's a threat.
That is a very good card.
And Mage has absolutely no good way to deal with it. I mean, Thais, even if he pings the shield off and attacks with Healbot and Flamestrike pings, like, he can clear everything. That's not the issue. It's just that the 5-5 weapon is really dangerous.
I think it's one of the problems when you run two Healbots, right? You have to cut something, and it might have been one of those cycle cards. And this is
so cut one Arcane Intellect, and...
Oh, well, you don't cut Arcane Intellect, can you?
Well, what's the cycle? There's two Acolytes.
Maybe there's like... Well, we saw Taish play a Loot Hoarder, did we? Like, usually that's kind of like the flex slot.
Right.
But like, maybe people have been usually only running one. But when you run two, your deck is like a bit more consistent.
Yeah.
Taish just respects the aggro matchup a bit too much, I think.
Yeah, I think going into this phase, maybe he expected more aggression. Because honestly, the ladder has been plagued with aggro. Like, in the first 2 days of TGT, it was just pure aggro. So maybe he thought... I'm going to have to deal with a lot more of that. And so he prepared accordingly. But it turns out that people at the higher ranks don't necessarily respect or believe in aggro as much as maybe in the earlier stages.
Exactly. Well, Taish believes that pushing one damage is more important than removing 5 damage here.
Might get punished for that?
I mean, the thing is like, Eloise is thinking right now whether that one damage is relevant or not. Because at the same time, you do need to kill your freeze mage opponent before they kills you. This game really goes to fatigue.
It's actually surprising because usually the paladin is the one who's just guaranteed to lose. Alexstrasza comes down and you just win right away, like as a freeze mage.
Mm-hmm.
But the hand from Thais was so clunky. You know, you said it was the weirdest Alexstrasza you'd ever
seen.
I think it was. I really think this is like obviously the weirdest Alexstrasza. Like it did nothing. There was no pressure from it. It was the weirdest thing.
Yeah. Well, this Alexstrasza is really following the rules.
Oh god.
Alright. Yep. Eloise agrees with the aggressive play. And well.
That actually could do it. But now for not killing, if you're gonna do that, you have to kill Alex. You can't give him the Archmage, right?
Exactly. So yeah, that's a little bit...
You might have to freeze Sylvanas.
Yeah, you're going to Ice Lance Sylvanas, and you're probably going to Ice Lance
the face.
The face would be good, so that you can actually remove the board.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, just get two fireballs here. And Taish is suddenly looking like it's... Oh! Whoa!
Double fireball ping? This guy is hopeful that everything's going to work out, but that's a guaranteed steal with...
Yeah, Taish is just going to give up his Antonitis. That is really cool. Alright then.
Thais believes in the top decks.
Alright, Eloise.
You know what though? I kind of like this because he knows if he gets one Frostbolt with the fireballs, he wins. And if he picks up Pyroblast, he can probably win. And he's got the other Ice Block to live another round of turns.
Okay.
So I kind of understand the reasoning and I'm not against it. Considering you know you're about to draw your entire deck, it's either Arcane Intellect's top deck. Which are going to give you the card draw you need to find that lethal.
Mm-hmm.
Or you're going to top deck the burn directly, which again gives you the lethal. So I think Thais playing the odds here, definitely a good play. But we'll see if, you know, there's still a potential to backfire here. There is definitely a potential for this entire thing to backfire.
There is, but then we still haven't seen like Arcane Intellect at all. We still haven't seen a single burn spell at all. Those two fireballs are not drawn, so there are still two fireballs in the deck.
He's almost got to find it now, though, because if he can find burn, he can't wait for it. Like, it needs to be Pyroblast or Frostbolt.
Alright, what is it?
Let it not be Arcane Intellect, this could be the losing play.
Oh! Wow, talk about dead cards.
Full face, draw the Doomsayer.
Yep.
Hope it does something.
Just gotta go full face. I mean.
But I think, on average, his top decks give him lethal.
That's true, yeah, on average.
On average. Like, actually, Arcane Intellect.
Arcane Intellect, Frostbolts, Fireballs.
What I like about the ping here over the second Fireball is that he can actually still get lethal if his opponent goes for a True Server heal.
Yeah.
Whereas if he didn't ping here, he was actually going to be one off.
That is true. That ping was pretty important.
I really like Thais playing Freeze Mage. He's such a great player.
Mm-hmm. Alright, well, Eloise is gonna do what she can to reduce Taj to one life and then proc the block. But it seems like Taj has two draws, right? If he actually messes up on this draw, he gets an ice block and gets mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's got one more chance. I don't know if there's a Lothab in Eloise's list, but I doubt it.
Well, I mean, even though the dude here is very important not to play a hero power. And oh! Oh, that is
Dice brutal. Is bricking on every street, but he's guaranteed lethal for the next turn if he can just not give Eloise any health.
No health.
He, yeah, no health. And you know what's funny?
Dodge the Leon hands, dodge the Huskar Jouster, dodge the Antique Heal Bot.
Dodge everything.
Alright, what's this gonna be? And oh!
Oh my god! Eloise breathing a sigh of relief. Okay. Oh, she's like, I can't believe I got this. But Thais is gonna top deck, right? It's just gonna be a counter top deck.
No, it might be just a... It's just a... What could it be? It could be Ice Barrier. And it'll be like just terrible.
No, don't say that, Amaz. Don't say that. Don't say that.
Ice Barrier? And...
Oh my...
Oh... Brutal! Absolutely brutal.
Amaz, you are responsible for this loss and Nihilim would hold it against you for the rest of your life. Do you even know what you did here?
Wait, how many cards? 7 cards. So 2 Fireballs, 2 Frost Bolts,
2 Arcane Intellect, 2 Acolyte of Fane.
1 Acolyte of Fane. So that was the only card that worked.
Oh, maybe Acolyte with like a single ping that drew into Ice Barrier. But the odds of this not working were like 1 in like 7. Like, or 8. He had almost no chances of losing this. He played it perfectly, but Eloise needed exactly that card. Oh, man.
Eloise top decked the True Silver, and Taj top decked exactly the wrong card. Like,
yeah.
I don't know. It was like, wow.
This must feel really bad. But then again, well played by Thais. One thing we can say is that he's played that match, I think, considering the card draw that he had or the draw that he got. He navigated this very well, and he was almost guaranteed the win if it wasn't for that True Silver or possibly a Leon Hand top deck by Eloise. Oh man, I still can't believe Tuskar Jouster winning the joust, low chances.
Oh man, absolutely brutal.
Yeah.
Everything worked out for Eloise there. So Temple Storm is going to be on the board for and the Paladin is going to be through. I think they're going to be pretty excited about that because considering that, you know, Paladin might be considered one of the weaker classes. I mean, it's a strong class, but you know, you got the Patriot Warrior and the Hunters, you know, those are kind of like the core classes. So definitely a good win for them. And Nihilim, well, if they send a Taj again, they might have to face the bench rule where if a player loses 2 games in a row, they actually are benched and cannot play in any further series until a teammate wins a game for them.
Yeah, so what's interesting is when you've got like the Druid lined up with Hyped here, he really wants to pick off something like a Freeze Mage. So if Thais goes out, if Temple Storm expects that, they might just queue the Druid in. Other than that, I don't know if I'd really like to pit the Druid against anything at the moment. I mean, I guess Darnassus Aspirant has made Druid a bit more consistent and powerful than it was, as weird as that might sound. It's kind of nice to see that the classes might go from, I wouldn't say lower tier, because you know it's a great deck, but it's somewhat inconsistent. We've seen it in the Archon Team League. In its current iteration, pre-TGT, it was a bit lacking. And now with the Darnassus Aspirant, I suspect the class will come back on top. Maybe it's giving it a bit of a better matchup against the field, and so you're happy to just, you know, throw it out there as opposed to try to target Freeze Mage.
It's pretty cool how one card, the Darnassus Aspirant, makes Druid lists so different, right? We see Chill and Yetis coming back in the game. We see Violet Teachers, right? So the Darnassus Aspirant actually makes 4 drops much more juicy for the Druid players. It's really cool, just one card changing up the whole deck.
So do you think we'll see like Chill and Yetis coming back?
Well, Hype is using the Violet Teacher list.
Right, okay, cool.
Yep, and Sixo is using the Chill and Yetis. So it's pretty cool that you know, even with 4 drops, people have like different opinions on which one is the better card. But Hyped's Warrior is gonna face against RDU's Hunter now, and Hyped is playing Patron Warrior, and RDU is playing the the more mid range. Oh, actually no, it was more of the hybrid Hunter, but it was very, very aggressive. I think it was like very similar to Chalky's.
That's pretty much the rule of hybrid. I think nowadays, like, there are hybrids that err on the slower side, but most of the time you see them just push phase very frequently and fast, which is one of the ways, I think, that makes... I think you can abuse that in Hunter very well. So I wouldn't be surprised to see that deck stick around. If we ever see a Lock and Load Hunter, I think it'll take a lot of refinement for it to really see the day.
Well,
so it's still a bit early for it.
Looking at the starting hand, RDU seems like he has exactly what he wants. We're at a one drop in the Mad Scientist, but Hyped actually taking in that Cruel Taskmaster. It's going to punish the one health creature quite well.
Yeah, I mean, Cruel Taskmaster doesn't get much better than that as a starting hand. I guess you're looking for Fiery War Axe still at this point. Do you keep Emperor Thorsen? In Patron Warrior, it's one of the key cards to just getting an auto win, but against a Hunter, maybe you're looking for something a bit faster, mm-hmm. right?
Well, it seems like against Hunter, you're going to survive if you get past turn 7, right? It's like you got to it's all pure survival mode. And looking at Hype's hand, that is just one of the best. Already picked up a Leopard Gnome, which is kind of perfect. You can save the Abusive for later, but yeah, this Taskmaster is going to be pretty bad news.
Yeah, the worst part about the Taskmaster is that its Battle Cry is good, but what's even better is the fact that it's going to trade 2-for-1 guaranteed. Like, unless you have a Glaivezuka, and if you Glaivezuka on turn 2 without a minion on the board as a hybrid or face hunter, you hate life. So every play you make following this is usually excruciating.
Yeah, you can see that RDU is already very in a very uncomfortable situation just based on that one very easy play.
Yeah, and it's not about to get better either. Like, this is...
Yeah.
Oh, well. Fire War Axes for days.
Yep. And if I remember correctly, RDU is only playing 2 freezings.
Alright, so that's already going to be one of them out of the way without a bow equipped. And it's going to give him another Cruel Taskmaster activation if he's looking for it.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, 4 mana Cruel Taskmaster doesn't seem like the best in a lot of situations, but against a Hunter where you have a lot of targets. And there you go.
RD is wondering, how do I win against the Fiery War Axe after Cruel Taskmaster on my turn 1 Leopard Gnome?
Oh my god.
Nice minion you got there.
Yep. Well, 24 health doesn't really mean much to a warrior, because like, against Priest and against Warrior, those are only the 2 matches where life is the exact number, right? I mean, 24 is not counting down to 22 and 20. It's going to stay at 24 unless you do something to them.
Yeah. There's 2 classes against Hunter that do that, basically. And with Jessicar True Heart, I'm hoping we see a bit more of the reverse, where Hunter's trying to wear you down and you just keep getting health. That's still pretty good. All right, so I think the fact that Acolyte, the Abusive Sergeant, and Hero Power last turn were played, does that indicate there was no bow in the hand? Or does that indicate that he simply wanted to weave in more Hero Powers?
Well, of course it indicates that you do not have a turn 3 play, because Abusive is deal 2 damage, right? Mm-hmm. And if you play with nothing, it becomes a vanilla 2-1, and you never want to do that. So, yeah, definitely hints that. Speaking of Jessicar Trueheart,
Did
you think that Blizzard think that it was too insane with Hunters and didn't give them double Hero Power?
Yeah, I think that's what happened. Because if I actually tried out Jessicar in the Lock and Load deck, right. And she's pretty good at 3. But if she was 4, the deck I think might be pushed over the top. Just because of it, like the inevitability of the Hero Power hits everyone. And if they don't have Jessicar, you win pretty much every time.
Actually, if we look at it another way, Jessicar can only increase 1 damage in damage dealing classes, right? So yeah, Druid gets 1 attack.
Always.
Mage gets 1 more attack. So Hunter, I guess, gets 1 more attack. I guess it makes sense.
Yeah, that's the goal. I think they didn't want people to push for damage. It's mostly a defensive card, it feels.
Yeah.
Oh man, Hyped with the hand.
That's RDU's hand just looks so terrible right now. Hype can just, like, you know, do whatever he wants, like, do his own strategy. Usually, you don't really want to play 4 drops, because every time you play a 4 drop, effectively, you're paying 2 life.
Yeah, because you're guaranteed to lose that extra armor that you would have otherwise gotten.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, my God.
So, this is pretty bad.
You don't say.
Is there a chance for RDU to... RDU's face tells the story.
Yeah.
This face is saying everything we've got on our minds right now, which is...
Best face.
Poor RDU. Oh, man. Nihilum is not having a good day so far.
Yeah.
But it's just the beginning of the day, right? Like, let's not get tilted too much just yet.
Uh-huh.
Not yet. There's still a chance, RDU.
I think the only saving grace for RDU is that in patron decks, usually you cut Armorsmiths for Taskmasters, so that you can actually, you know, do a little bit more combo stuff with, like, you know, Taskmastering your Acolyte, Taskmastering your Patron Warrior for, like, effectively 7 damage, right? Spots a new patron, does a 2-2 extra buff, and it's a 2-2 body itself. So it's actually, like, more flexible that way, but of course, yeah, lose out the armor.
So I think here RDU is not going to have any choice but to just push with Unleash Abusive Hero Power and hope that he can weave in the kill commands with the Hunted Keeper, right?
Yeah, I mean, he's facing what? The board looks like 15 damage.
Yeah.
So he only has a 2-turn clock, right? So he needs to win in 2 turns.
That seems to be the only way. Like, you can push for 8 this turn, which is pretty good.
Yeah, 8 this turn, and then you need to... Is there any 1 mana beast? Not really, right? And I mean, Hyped is obviously going to armor up.
Yeah, so there's no way he doesn't. So the insta-kill is not really happening. But at least Hyped is going to have to answer your board. And by doing so, there's a chance that the patrons don't go to your face. So maybe, just maybe, you're able to stay alive. Because if Hyped goes full phase, then sure, you're on a 2-turn clock. But if you ask to remove your board, then there's a chance.
Yeah. Well, here we go. RDU's only move.
Is he going to kill command?
No, Abusive is the one that's actually not only a body, so it's 5 bodies to 4. It also has a condition where you actually have the minion that charges the face.
Yeah. Well, Hyped is looking for the Warsong Commander or the Armorsmith or both. Didn't pick up either of them. He can't draw this turn, so I think there's a chance that RDU can take this.
Well, still, interestingly enough, I think the move here is to just play
Deathbite and override it. Oh, yeah.
I mean, the only way to put lethal, right? You do lose to Unleash the Hounds number 2, though. You take
7. Yeah, well, yeah, you'd be pretty much dead. Unless the Hunter drew dead on kill commands.
Yeah.
But that's pretty unlikely.
But that's pretty much the best move here. Because, like, you already saw Unleash the Hounds. The probability of having a second one is actually really bad. And we see that if Hyped actually done that, and there's 10 health, RDU can't actually kill him. Kill commands and hero powers. You only have 7 mana. 7 mana is not going to do it.
Yep, he'd have to have an extra bit of mana there to do it.
All right,
so we fully expect the override weapon.
Yep, but you should attack first, of course. Don't waste the 4 damage.
4 damage is good.
Yeah, might as well take it. And now RDU needs to find exactly Unleash the Hounds. There is no other card that actually helps him here. But I mean, Kaish did top deck the Ice Barrier, so it's only
right,
just.
I guess we can just keep going. Is that Unleashed? That's not Unleashed.
Well.
RDU in disbelief. It kind of looks like his poster. He's like, what is this? Even the poster is like, wait, what is this?
Yeah.
Oh man.
He's in so much pain. Just...
Yeah, it looks like the pain is physical at this point. It's not even just psychological.
Yep.
I can't help but laugh. Like,
why did I not draw Creeper? Like any other turn, not just. Yeah. Well, that's pretty much it. You can pretty much sit there all you want, but that's it.
Yep. Well, this is the end. Well, it's the end, but I wonder what RDU is.
He's just conceding, yeah. Just like, gotta take in that 1 minute to... You know,
calm down a bit. Okay.
Calm down. You know, I was like,
all right, I can get that. So it's like the cool factor. You need to cool down a little bit before you concede and maybe get queued up into the next match. And then still on tilt or enraged from the loss, you just kind of pilot your deck poorly.
Man, 2 very unlucky games for Nihilim, I have to say.
Yeah.
Because, like, the Hybrid Hunter against the Patron Warrior, it's usually not that good just because the armor Swiss, but because they were teched out, then it's actually, like, a bit more balanced. I might even venture to say that the Hybrid Hunter would be a bit better, but not the case, because RDU just hero powered for like 4 turns straight.
But they did have pretty good RNG, I think, in the past days, so maybe that kind of compensates a little bit.
I guess the Taskmaster kind of accomplished what the armor smith is supposed to do anyways at the start too, right?
Yeah, remove something and mitigate damage. Yeah, exactly. It's done pretty much the same thing. But in this case, it also ate up a freezing trap, mm-hmm. which might have been a big deal. It wasn't exactly the biggest thing, but yeah, I guess you're right. Man, Temple Storm with a small lead here over Nihilum. Then again, we have to mention that this has happened like many times so far in the Archon Team League Championships, where somebody gets an early lead of like 2 to 3 matches, and then the other team just equalizes. So it's, I think what's most important is once you get to that, you know, 3 to 3 stage, if you get there, you know, you never hope that one team goes 6-0 over their opponents. Once you get to the equal stage, like three wins on either side, then the matchups are starting to look very determining.
Yeah, I mean, obviously 6 decks versus 6 decks, you don't really know which one to lead in. You usually lead in with your strongest decks, like Taj lead in with the Freeze Mage and expect to win. But yeah, sometimes bad things happen. And when your opponent has 2 wins already, matchups look better at your side. So you can kind of see like an underdog effect there. Like mm-hmm. when you're lacking behind, you can always kind of, you know, you have a bigger percentage of guessing what your opponent's deck is playing just by like numbers and math themselves. So.
Oh man, math. Hearthstone has math, Amaz.
Sometimes, you know, sometimes when you play Matter Bomber and your opponent has 6 health, you can see that 6 times equals 6.
Really? What was the math? 8 equals 11? I forget.
8 equals... I once tried to BGH a Kel'Thuzad in a tournament match. And
right, 6 equals 7. That doesn't quite work.
There's a lot of those. But you learn. You learn.
Yeah, you learn. You do it once, right?
Yeah, Hype is going to step up to the plate again with Druid. And Life Coach is going to be playing Paladin. His very control-heavy Paladin. We saw like Lay on Hands. And we saw like really, really high ramping stuff. And Hype is, of course, playing the Darnassus Aspirant Druid. That we see that as a pretty prevalent right now, but instead of Chill and Yetis or other some 4-drops, he's using Violet Teachers instead.
I think that's a great choice. I mean, it's still one of those decks that even though the standard list could take wins, and I think Darnassus Aspirant is making it so much more consistent that like Druid might actually become a tier 1 deck again at some point. But we're going to have to see how the metagame evolves in the near future. How do you think it fares against a really greedy Paladin like this? Because Life Coach, his list is on the super control side, which I find kind of amusing since most of the Paladins we see nowadays are very mid-range oriented.
Yeah, mid-range Paladin is definitely better against Druid just because you have those early threats, right? You have more consistency. And Druids, once again, it's not known for removing minions and placing minions. They can only do one of each usually. And that's why Paladins just like kind of steamroll. Things that trade 2-for-1, such as True Silver Champion, are very, very key cards for the Paladin. And sometimes even just a muster for battle is enough to actually stop Druids in the tracks if they don't get a swipe. So, yeah. Like, the Druid seems like the one always answering the questions. And if Paladins have the hardest questions, then it's just kind of very, very, very difficult to win for the Druid side.
Yep, we'll see if that changes at all. Oh, Gadget and Jouster in Life Coach's deck. So that's like a zombie chow. It's almost guaranteed to win.
Well, Wildgrove does save this hand a little bit. Man, this hand is like the best 2 cards and the worst 2 cards all in one.
All right. Well, we have to assume Life Coach takes the Joust more often than not here, but he loses it and ends up with a 1-mana 1/2.
Yeah, this is the problem with these cards, right? You still have to run Shielded Mini Bots, so there's always that chance where you just don't get anything. And is that really worth it to sacrifice +1/+1 when you don't want to heal your opponent for what is it, 5 health? Is it really that much big of a deal?
It really depends on how much you value dealing phase damage to your opponent. It's kind of like the Wrathguard argument, right? Some people say, well, it's a 2-mana 4/3, so that's a great card. And the question then becomes, how much do you value your own health in the deck that would run the Wrathguard? And it turns out that the health, even though we disregard it as a resource, and you know you should use it up and abuse it, it seems like nowadays people are starting to consider the health a bit more valuable than it used to be. I think maybe as a result of having so much tempo damage coming in, like every class now can tempo you down. Even priests can just beat you up by turn 7.
Right, exactly. All right, well, I'm pretty sure Hyped is going to do one of his 5 drops here. just because you just need to establish minion, right? Druid is very tempo oriented. You're not going to hero part and just pass another turn. And also on the topic of the Zombie Chow versus Garizan Jobster, seems like Life Coach is running more of a control paladin based on the cards we've seen yesterday.
Yeah.
And healing your opponent with a control deck doesn't seem like that much of big of a deal.
Yeah, no, I agree with you for the most part. Which is, I think your point makes a lot of sense when you consider the archetype. Yeah.
Yeah. This I'm just looking at this 1-2 and it looks really silly. Like 1-2 is possibly like the worst stat line. Because even like 1-1s, like Web Spinner, they actually do something, right? 1-2s are just like bad.
Hey, it's like you're paying for a Wisp. Like it's like if I tell you, it's so awful.
I would play Wisp for that, right?
Yeah, I'm sure you would. You can weave it at the end of a turn or at the beginning of it.
Drew of the taunt. It's gonna give him, Hyped a little bit of a wall.
The little overpay on the Innervate, but at the same time, what can you do, really? Now, the only drawback to playing the Druid of the Claw here is that you're guaranteed to give your opponent a True Summer Champion kill if he's got the coin with the weapon. Mm-hmm. But again, you can play Lotheb as a follow-up on turn 5, and he can't kill it. Because if he decides to kill the Druid of the Claw now, he won't have a 1-1 on the board to kill Lotheb. So you could transition to turn 6 and 7 quite nicely.
Yeah, doubly as lucky for Hyped is that Life Coach doesn't even have the True Silver Champion.
Right.
Probably have to go with the Aldor here. And, you know, Aldor creatures that have really, really high health are actually very detrimental to paladins. They just keep on eating your hero powers.
The genocide creatures is what you're turning them into.
Yeah, pretty much. Bears are pretty aggressive, right?
So this guy will get like 6 kills before he's gone. Move quickly. Now, Life Coach has to decide what he wants to do. Now, again, it's all about whether or not you value this. Like, do you expect your opponent to play another minion on the back of this? If yes, then maybe you just use your 1-1. Like, you don't have to use your 1-1. If you expect him to hero power, then you use your 1-1.
Oh, man. Hype draws another dead card, but this Lothab is going to be so detrimental. Oh, wow. He's actually thinking of Savage Roar.
Can't fault him, honestly. It'll kill the 1-2 and the 3-3.
Yeah, just because your hand is so dead, right? I mean, Hype's, if he plays Lothab right now, it's going to be so sick. So good. Life Coach effectively passes another turn.
Yeah, he can't. He has to, like, muster for battle to kill that 1-6 if he wants, but he can't do it if Lothab gets played. Oh, Hype is gonna go for it.
Yeah, I think he's better of himself.
Wow. That is arguably the most awful situation Life Coach could be in at this point. Although, like, if you look at the entire game, it's lucky for him that Hyped had a pretty horrible start. Because if that Innervate had been present with stronger cards like a Shredder, then things would have been maybe very different at the end of this.
Hmm.
And Life Coach is still in pretty good shape when you consider the equality consecration that he can pull off. He can win the long game at the moment. I wonder if is there even a 6 drop in Hyped's deck that's not Emperor Thorsen? Sylvanas,
no.
Maybe?
No, Sylvanas maybe, but yeah. Plus pretty much no, right? You would just want to wrap into your 4 drops. It's a million 4 drops, and 4 drops are really, really good at 6, turn 6. That's alright too.
Yeah, it lets you play your hero power. It's a bit off-curve, but then again, you know, when you're already so far off-curve, you just take what you get.
Exactly.
But you almost don't want to play the Shade because you expect Consecration to hit. I mean, imagine Consecration next turn followed by the 3-2 into your Lotheb. So if you play the Shade, I think you have to kill a 3-2 with your Bear and your Hill Power. Oh, man. Hyped with nothing but bad decisions to take.
Yeah, I mean, I think you just have to play the Shade and just hope your opponent doesn't have a Consecrate, right? I mean, like, are you going to really just pass a turn and just... Well, I guess you could. If you play, like, if you draw a 4-drop along with the Shade, that's the turn 7. But, I don't know. I really see Finish as, like, the only option. It's going to get punished, but what can you do with this hand?
You hope to find Emperor Thorsen and just burst your opponent down at some point, and he's gonna go for the Shade, kill the 3-2. So he's really playing around Consecration. I have to say, I really like that play from Hyped. He knows that his only way to win is to not lose his board to a single Consecration, and there's a good chance he keeps his Lotheb here, unless Life Coach goes for the equality.
Yeah, equality doesn't seem that good, obviously.
Exactly.
The classic crit. So I would actually prefer to see something like, I don't know, Aldor instead. Let me think.
Aldor is a bit slower, but at the same time, you're guaranteed to wipe the board eventually with just equality consecration. So I guess you can take your time. Life Coach has to be assuming that Hive's hand either contains an Ancient of Lore or combo pieces. Just based on the speed at which this has been played, maybe a Scenarios. Do they know each other's deck completely?
Not completely. They don't have okay. Deck lists, but they can actually watch the re-podcast, of course.
Yeah.
So, maybe they figure something out there. But, oh, Equality is going to come down here.
Life Coach is going to go for the play that puts him the further ahead.
Yep.
The Muster for Battle will be played, forcing a swipe out of his opponent, still allowing him to coin out the Dr. Boom next turn.
Yeah, you can also have an option to consecrate and kill the shit next turn if it actually survives. And
oh, nice pickup here by Hype. And what's really good about this is that it'll push a lot of damage to the Paladin's face, which means your Savage Roar with swipe here, and that's a lot of burst.
Yeah, that's actually exactly what Hype wanted. Now, Hype is actually thinking whether he wants to push face with one Savage Roar and then just combo Life Coach out afterwards. We know that might not be the best plan because Life Coach has a anti-heal bot. But if we don't know what Life Coach is holding, how much damage is this?
We're pushing. That's exactly lethal, actually. If he ends up pushing full face, he's putting his opponent on 14.
14?
Yeah, exactly.
So he just needs one more turn and he actually can win the game. Not to mention he still has a shade that his opponent has to deal with, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. If your opponent doesn't deal with the shade, if somehow he doesn't have the consecration, then you think your Force of Nature or Savage Roar is even better. And you know what? Even if the healbot falls, that means the shade doesn't get killed immediately, right?
Yeah. That's true.
So that's another wave of damage coming from Hyped.
All right. Gonna just save it. The other thing is, like, I guess you have one more Innervate left for the super combo, right?
Yeah, 22 damage right off the hand. Exactly. Easy.
Oh, just not going to play anything good.
So we've got Emperor Thorsten and the Innervate.
Yeah. What Life Coach doesn't know is that if he doesn't play Consecrate here, that shade might end up doing way too much damage.
It might end up killing you next turn, basically. There's a chance that the opponent has the combo plus Innervate, so that would kill you.
Well, no, I don't think you play an Innervate combo.
Right, of course. But then again, this is pretty much the only thing that's going to lose you the game at this stage, almost.
Oh, at the same time, this is like the last turn to kill the Shade. Mm-hmm. Right? You already used an Equality. The only other way to kill the Shade is like for lucky Boombot hits.
I could see him go for that. I could see him go for that because it's forcing the Druid to answer, and then there's a chance that the Boombot, even if they don't kill the Shade, will weaken it enough that the Consecration can finish it off, right? So even with bad shade RNG.
Yeah, and then you also have like anti-killbot to play afterwards. So I actually like coin Dr. Broom the most. I don't think you have time for Emperor, funny enough. Turn 6, you can't Emperor, you actually just need to raise. But no, Life Coach disagrees. Gonna go with Emperor anyways. Try and get some value out of his cards and play more.
Well, for one, we have to say that he is forcing the opponent to have the removal for this. Mm-hmm. But I don't think Hype minds it too much. I mean, at this point, I think I'd go for Shredder, Savage Roar, just push it. You're dealing 8 to your opponent, you're putting him in combo range, and next turn you're going to have maybe another minion from the Shredder. The Shade's going to be up. So maybe just pushing for damage here from Hyped.
Well, from Hyped's perspective, Life Coach doesn't actually have healing. So if Hyped actually holds on the Shade for one more turn and then use the combo afterwards, Life Coach is just dead. There's like no way to stop that, right? So not revealing the Shade might be better.
Oh, you're right. That's a great point.
Well, we're looking at this from Hype's perspective.
Right. What if you go... No. I was going to say, there's no reason to play Savage Roar solo if you're not going to push for Shade.
Exactly. Well, actually, there's another move you can do. You can actually trade the Emperor and play a Shredder. And then
that's going to hurt.
But that does not look nice at all. So
yeah. Then again, you know that your opponent has the coin. So Tyrion Forging, you know, can be played next turn anyway on 7. Lay on Hands could be played next turn on 7. So maybe you do have to play the trading game.
Yeah, well...
I'm hoping for Hype that he doesn't, because it feels like he just has to push here.
Yep, I'm just going to push. And not playing the Dr. Boom might end up being the game here, huh?
If I don't see a healbot here, this is not going to end well. there can't possibly not be a heal bot, right?
It's so... I mean, we're looking at this from the Paladin perspective, right?
Right.
Why did the Druid play a 4-mana drop?
His hand must be full of clunky cards that he's been holding. Like, those two cards in his hand have been there for, what, 8 turns now? Those aren't cards that he can play on curve ever.
Yeah. It's kind of like a method of elimination, right?
Right.
So, no Ancient of Lore, because Ancient of Lore would have went down. Mm-hmm. And then you can go from there. No Druid the Claw, because that's the next highest creature. You can still hero power after that. And, oh, seems like we're going to see an outdoor and... This might still be enough. This is actually really close.
So you got 6 damage on the board, plus 14, so 20. Yes. That's 24, actually.
24
is just shy. Without a bit more damage, you can't push for lethal. But then again, if you look at it from, you know, Hive's perspective, he still has lethal next turn, right? Unless Tyrion comes down or something along those lines.
Mm-hmm. Well, here, do you actually just play 1 Savage Roar and just go all in? So, because you have 14 damage next turn. If you play 1 Savage Roar, that's like a fireball, right? There's 3 total creatures, I guess, in a sense. So 6 plus 6 is like 12, 13 with hero power, and that's exactly 14.
Well, what if your opponent plays like a Trissor Champion? You have to push for everything you've got, maybe?
I mean, at this point, you're not gaining back on the board. You have to
find lethal
in 2 turns.
Right.
Yep. And you're also only staring at like 14 damage. 14 damage is not enough to kill you.
Hyped is listening to really good music. Or he's talking to his own inner self.
Yep, Hyped is
he's having a debate with himself. I'm liking this.
I hope it's okay, but no, it's just gonna go all in here.
Full face. Smell wet.
Yep.
Is he trading at all? I don't think so.
I mean,
well, that's a bit of a relief.
Die, right? So
one thing to say is that Hyped also has another Force of Nature in his deck, probably, and there's another swipe also that gives him a win. There's also a Druid of the Claw that can charge, so he's got, you know, 3 outs from the top that can still help out.
No, actually, that's it.
Is he dead?
Yeah, Savage Roar and the Hero Power. That's it.
Well, yeah, but the Paladin could heal with True Silver, right? So from his perspective, in the worst case scenario, Paladin has like True Silver for one heal,
What? How could Life Coach actually win this game?
Well, he does have like 15. Wait, how much damage does he have? Well, the juggles could win it.
The juggles could win it?
I think so.
Oh, wow. Exactly. I think so. Oh, my.
Yeah, exactly. Wait. Oh, no. Never mind. It's gone.
I was thinking of some, like, Shredder into, like, Wrathguard or something, and then you can, like, Consecrate and double dip damage with the Emperor.
Oh my god, the Wrathguard comes out.
Yeah.
It's unfortunately not gonna work, but...
No.
It's a Flame Juggler.
Well, and that's it!
Yes, Hyped playing the clunkiest Druid hand ever to a win against the Paladin.
Jeez.
Who seems to be holding onto the board, way too aggressively. Life Coach is closing his eyes, hoping Hyped doesn't have it, but there's no reason to go all in like this if you're not going to have lethal in the following turn. Life Coach knows it, and Hyde's going to seal the series just to take a lead over Nihilim. It's 3-0, and, you know, I mentioned earlier, some teams come back and equalize in the mid-game. This has to happen pretty much right now.
Yeah, well, Hyde is done for the day. He's going to basically cross his fingers and rely on Gaara and Eloise to seal it out. And over in Nihilim's side, not the best of starts. Each player with 1 loss each. So they will have to like regroup and form a better strategy. And that's the thing, right? Life Coach with his very control heavy Paladin might be the weakness of their lineup. It's just very inflexible.
Do you think it's weak or just too rigid in its game plan and too hard to make work against a variety of decks? Because it's going to target some specific things that you might not run up into necessarily by queuing at random in this format.
Well, and, I mean, look at this. Look at the matchups, right? You have the Gaara, the Hunter. You also have Eloise's Zoo. So control Paladin doesn't seem that good against those classes already. And then you also have the Priest. And the Priest is obviously really, really good against the Paladin. It is a kind of a weakness. And not only that, Life Coach is also running the Gadgets and Jouster, where if that was a Somichal last game, it might have been a bit different. 1-2 didn't really do anything. If it was a 2-3, it actually could have actually attacked the Drew of the Claw, right? The 1-2 couldn't have done anything with 1-6. So it just,
yeah, the 1-2 just takes two hits, and that was
exactly
it. Zombie Chao might have actually been the win, you're right. Like, exactly. It sounds ridiculous to say that, but it's true. Like, that single joust, it's small moments like this that I guess in a game make you evaluate cards differently, because you see them in action, and just the marginal joust losses. I get the feeling a lot of people will stay away from that mechanic because of its inconsistency. Like, maybe Tusk or Jouster is fine, because as you mentioned, you know, the flexibility of it. Right. But you're not playing it for the joust effect, right? You're playing it at that point for the flexibility with the added benefit of getting you that clutch heal once in a while.
Right, so. And like, speaking in the Garrison Jouster, you're not even actually getting a benefit. Does that make sense? Like,
yeah,
you win
right,
a joust,
right.
Yeah, you get a zombie chow. And if you don't win a joust, well, you're kind of screwed.
Yeah.
So those
you get a bad gold chart footman, so I guess that's not worth it.
So like, the best case scenario, you get a normal one drop. I think we'll pass on that. Anyways, new decks will have to be picked here. Gaara should be able to step up to the plate. It would be nice. Or actually, it's interesting because Tempestorm wants to send out Gaara, so they actually have the flexibility, right, between players.
Yes.
But if Nihilim expects that, it might be advantageous for Tempestorm to actually send Eloise and trick them up, because it might be very easy to target both a Priest and a Hunter. I'm not really sure what does that, though.
Well, Patron Warrior could probably beat both if Life Coach is playing it, because Priests typically just get OTK'd no matter what you do.
Right.
Like, you can wait it out, and eventually the Patron Warrior will just kill you. And Hunter doesn't exactly have a great matchup against it.
Yeah. It seems like Taisha's Druid was also really good, because Druid against Hunter is really, really roll off, and Druid of course against Priest is obviously a very good matchup. But instead, we're gonna see the Hunter mirror. Man, we saw this yesterday, and it actually decided the game for RDO, where he wrote exactly the animal companions he needed. And
I guess the luck was thrown against Thais today. RDU threw all the good luck and gave it to his opponent, and then he threw it in Thais' face in the first match.
Mm-hmm.
Never draw what you need, right?
Exactly. Well, hopefully RDU has a better draw this time around. We know that when he played against Hype's Warrior, it was pretty abysmal. His draws were just direct damage, and you don't want that early game. So hopefully for Nihilim, they can actually win the first point. Of course, Temple Storm is looking to just seal it out with a 6-0. Do you think it's going to be a 6-0?
I hope not. Well, I mean, I hope so in a way, because it'll be the first one. It's super exciting, but I hope not, because the soul of whoever is on the receiving end of that is just crushed forever after that point.
Oh man, I think Crypt would love to see some souls get crushed.
Yeah, I'll page him once, man, if this goes to 6-0.
He just gets so happy.
Yeah. Crypt likes to see other people be miserable.
Yeah. Well, here you go. This Aryan Squire looks pretty good as a tournament play.
Yeah.
Seal off all other one drops for Hunters. And this is exactly why you play Aryan Squire, right? Is there a reasoning to play Leper Gnome to push more damage instead?
Well, I think Leper Gnome is overall more damage if you're just going to go phase and get contested on the board in a way. But you can remove things so much more easily with the Aryan Squire. Right. Now, it all depends on what Secret Gaara is playing, right? Because Explosive Trap, if you're feeding the Abusive Sergeant into this, would be pretty horrible. On the other hand, you can play your own Mad Scientist. Well, there goes.
Yeah, I do remember Gaara playing a Bear Trap, and I think one freezing as well, but we don't know if any more comes from that. And there we go, exactly. There's the Bear Trap. We'll see if it's actually going to pay off. It is a 2-mana summon of 3-3, and that is above curve.
Yeah, what I like about Bear Trap is that when you're on the coin and you play it on curve, it's the only trap that I'm happy to play from my hand. Because on the coin, I'm getting this 3-3. It's unlikely they can kill it by that point, and then I can usually coin out a Houndmaster on it, depending on the deck. It's a really nice card. It's funny that they made a trap that I'm happier to play from hand than not. Wow.
Wow, a 3-2 that draws a card is infinitely better than a
Novice Engineer.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Alright, well, both players get a secret each. We have a freezing trap. We do not really know what Gaara's trap is, but it's okay, we can kind of guess.
We'll figure it out. Probably a freezing.
Alright.
I'm guessing a freezing if there's one.
Oh, it's a Sad days for RDO once again. Man, it's just not RDO's day, huh?
Yeah, 3-mana 1/1 with Divine Shield is infinitely worse than a Scarlet Crusader.
Well, gotta play the Leper Gnome here. Whoa!
He hero powered instead, doesn't want to put the minion down.
Okay. Interesting.
Yara will probably have two beasts on this board to use with the Houndmaster. Gets the best one against RDU.
That is so good. You get Houndmaster. Oh my god.
You can even replay that Jouster if you want.
Well,
it's still not looking amazing.
It's looking grim again for Nihilum.
Wait, what if you... No, you'd never do that.
Wait,
kill command, 3-2.
Oh, no. Just because, like, hunters have unleashed the hounds, you don't want to really...
Yeah.
That. You don't want to try and be cute with a trap. If the trap actually, you know, normally kills a 3-2, it's a dark bomb, so good enough.
No, Gaara's got to make a decision whether he wants to play this slow or not. I mean, he's in a position where he can make that call. He could decide to play the game a bit slower.
All right, well, there's the freezing trap, and you already have a beast on the board. I guess Misha already has taunt, but just getting that buff immediately is just too good. And it also pushes for damage.
Not a bad pickup here for RDU, but again, this is not a type of board you're happy to play something like Juggler Unleash on. This is...
Oh, I think you have to.
It's not the type of board where you're happy to do it. That's the thing. Like, you're going to do it by necessity, but there are so many circumstances where that play is very often better. But when you've got nothing else to do, it's kind of mandatory.
No, I think it's fine. I mean...
What about a double?
I think you're too unhappy playing Unleash... Knife Juggler Unleash here. It deals 4 damage across the board. And if you get some lucky juggles and you get some lucky shredder, it might be good. Oh, gonna pop it first?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, probably see if that thing hits one of the minions.
Yeah, we need one knife to hit. There you go, there's one. Alright.
Alright, the board is clear.
Alright, that's pretty good.
More than clear, actually. And now the ball is back in Gaara's court. And I wouldn't like to have to handle this.
Houndmaster again. So yeah, Gaara is definitely playing a super mid-range hunter. With King's Elec and Houndmaster, it's very, very, very slow. And hunters, even though they're slow, they can be really fast. Quick shot into a bear trap. We'll see if RDU can actually play around this bear trap.
Yeah, I think with a board like this, it's pretty simple. I mean, you would like to trigger freezing and bear trap with the hound either way, right?
Exactly.
Like, no matter which order it is. You have to attack with the hound first. So yeah, this trap for Gaara is... like a second quick shot. It's killing the Mad Bomber.
Okay.
Oh, man. Unless RDU... No, no way. No, there's no way RDU does anything like that. It's too insane. Using the Bomber to hit face and then kill commanding the 3-3 to keep the Hound. It does nothing.
Alright. Flying Bear comes to the rescue.
Do you want to keep that 3-3? Like, do you value the 3-2? Over the kill command?
Yeah, I guess you value minions on the board. Just repetitive damage.
Well, I guess that's the play. There was no unleash for Gaara, no explosive trap, nothing to handle this. And RD is not looking too bad at the moment.
Not looking too good either. Wow, that is a very, very good draw. But Gaara is, of course, going to play the Jaime on 6 and going to taunt it up with Houndmaster. It seems like this is RDU's kind of a last chance to actually go for the face of any taunts. And here we go. Pushing damage. Push more damage.
Well, he's got his opponent pretty low, honestly. Like, you start picking up the quick shots, you start picking up the direct damage. An Iron Beak Owl is also immediately lethal.
Yep, Iron Beak Owl would be the best. RDU's just gonna pray here. And Gaara, on the other hand, is going to look to set up his... Oh!
What a crazy pickup by Gaara. He's going to clean up most of the board there.
But is that man. Even good? That's the question.
Well, you kind of have to, because you can Houndmaster anyway, right?
That's true. Yeah, just clear everything except for...
the few things you can't. It's kind of unfortunate for him that some minions have, like, 2 effective health, and 4 in the case of Creeper.
Exactly.
So he's not really clearing everything.
Yeah, that's true.
RDU again with the lip bite.
Yeah, like, I mean, it's kind of disgusting how this series is going right now. Temple Storm is getting like super lucky with their top decks, and not only that, Nihilum is getting super unlucky with their top decks. And when you combine both of them together, that's pretty insane. Gaara actually sets up lethal next turn, right? You just need to set up lethal next turn.
That's so if you think about this, kill command is lethal for RDU. Yes. Because he can then just sacrifice a Leper Gnome and Hero Power.
Yeah, Leper Gnome doesn't care about taunt. Just goes face.
Don't just cheat. So there's like three outs left in his deck.
Oh, of course. Of course not. Like, why would he draw it?
Oh, man. He's even one damage off of killing that high main.
I mean, yeah. Yeah, but...
That's so excruciating.
Absolutely brutal.
RDU.
No.
That's, not gonna cut it.
That's not it. We just have to... Oh, man. It's like we're watching the history repeat itself, right? RDU is like exactly like this in the Patreon game where you're just staring at the screen. And just so helpless.
Yeah, but at least there's no poster this time to go alongside it. It's just RDU.
No, actually, he is the poster now.
Oh, man.
Wow.
That's so meta.
4-0 for Templestar.
You gotta feel a little bad for Nihilum here because these games, some of them... Like, I don't have anything to say about, you know, Thaisa's gameplay. You know, there are a few plays that we thought were really weird. You know, that Alex draws a push face instead of killing Sylvanas. Right. And it turned out that this was the winning play most of the time. Like, all the small, subtle things that Thaisa did were perfect, and he lost the game. RDU had the most awful hand against Patron. Obviously, that lost him the game. The last match we saw with Paladin from Life Coach, Hyped had the worst hand possible, but Life Coach also didn't get anything worth pushing with, so he lost the game. And RDU now, in the mirror match, gets roadblocked by a high main. I think if there wasn't an Unleash the Hounds, there was lethal, because he could have gone through the high main and then pushed for the remaining damage. Wow, that was intense, I have to say.
Oh man, those top decks, man. Templestar really rocking it out. But of course, we still see a priest, and we still have Eloise's Fist of Jiraxxus Zulok, right? So
yeah.
Those two, I would say those two are the weakest decks if I took two weakest decks out of Templestar's lineup. So Nihilum just needs to bounce back and bully the weak decks with their own. And yeah, hopefully they can actually pass this back because it's not looking good for them at all.
I mean, this is the situation where I think the entire team's morale is way low because even if you get just good matchups going forward, even assuming everything is like a 65-35 in your favor, you're still likely to lose a series, right? This is the point where even with good matchups across the board, you're still likely to lose it.
I think it's back to like phase one again, where Nihilum is doing so good, and then when games actually started mattering the most, like it's crunch time, it's just like, oh man. Yeah. And then Redemption was like so close as well.
6-5, yeah.
Did you cast the Redemption series?
No, I wasn't casting it. I couldn't actually do it that Friday, but
the
it was really
close. Was just nuts. It was just so close as well. Gosh.
Yeah, Nihilum has had it very... I mean, the thing is, they had probably the biggest confidence boost off of the early phase one, right? Like, the first 5 weeks of phase one were guaranteed top two unless they lost with less than 4 wins on the following week, and then they lost the following match, and everything had to go super wrong, and it did. And then they went through Redemption, they figured, all right, we're going to be fine, they're in the winner's match today, can get to the live finals, and yep, not happening so far. They're going to have to pull off a crazy stunt to come back, but it's possible that they can exploit Priest and the weird warlock from Eloise.
Yeah. We'll have to see. I mean, for example, like Mech Shaman seems like it's really, really strong against the Wrathguard Zulok, right?
Right.
Sometimes you feel like, oh, I'm just going to play 4 Flamers. It doesn't really matter. But then, yeah, your health starts dwindling down. Your heart starts dwindling down. I mean, Zuloks usually trade quite a bit, right? You want to take some good trades. And if Wrathguard trades for 2 things, that's
yeah,
not
that's
even
like 6 damage to your face.
Yeah,
that's
insane. A lot of damage to your face. But, I mean, Wrathguard is kind of like a weapon, if you think of it another way, right? It's a weapon that doesn't lose durability if it hits the face. But if you trade, then you start taking damage as well.
Yeah, when you look at it that way, it's actually not a bad one, right? The only problem is it can get removed from a spell, whereas very often, you know, the weapons really can. But that retaliation, like the blowback on Wrathguard is insane.
Of course, we can't go through a broadcast without, you know, bringing that up.
Hey, we haven't brought it up in the past 3 times I was here, but I think I had to cycle it back in.
Oh, man. speaking of stats, which stats do you think are the most relevant in Hearthstone?
You mean, like, across everything, like win rates from classes and everything?
Anything, just like...
I think the odds of getting a 2-drop in your deck... On average?
Well, no, like statistics of like player stats.
Players? Oh, player stats. Oh my god, that's a tough one. I want to say win rate, but that's mediocre. Just like the obvious go-to.
Yeah. I think win rate is actually the one that's just relevant. Other stats, I don't think they're relevant at all, right?
Well, maybe like the percentages of the like, but this is mostly information interesting for your opponents, which is which classes do you favor most and which archetypes, right? Things like this, I think, can be super important, but mostly like mana saturation and all, that's not very impactful for me, because I think most of the high level players have a really refined and tight gameplay.
Exactly.
So it's hard to distinguish them.
Exactly. It's not like, for example, like a MOBA where kills are always good and kills are always bad, you know. Anyways, here's a good matchup for Nihilim again. Freeze Mage versus Zulok. When you're at 4 games down, you're going to bound to have some good matchups to start and climb back up. But who knows? We might see some crazy stuff happening. Eloise keeping the owl because she does know it's Freeze Mage.
Yep.
And Taish doesn't want any of those because those are not Cycle, those are not Doomsayers. And hey, that's a pretty good start hand. Whoa!
That's insane.
Shield Bearer is back in the meta?
I blame Reynad for telling Eloise that he used to run in his zoo.
Yeah,
what I do.
I don't know, Shield Bearer is just bad. Like, what?
You don't believe in Shield Bearer? Maybe it's because now you have to actually protect the Wrath Guard.
Oh!
You know, you actually have to not have that guy get punched in the face.
Well, you could also just play another creature that's not Wrath Guard and change the Shield Bearer into something that deals damage, you know? That might be a little bit better.
Moth, what is this sorcery? You don't believe in the Shield Bearer metagame? Haven't you heard of Bolster Warrior? Haven't you?
Oh man, maybe maybe in Bolster Warrior it's a good card. Oh, who knows?
That's a 2/6 with Taunt for 1 mana. Yeah. I'll take that.
Bolster of Hogger sounds pretty nice too.
Yeah, if you can get enough taunts on the board. All right, so it's looking like a pretty early Doomsayer for Thais, which is going to try to just deny his opponent the tempo while he establishes the card draw.
Yeah, and actually, Eloise could skip the owl here. You're only losing a board of 2.
But it's probably worth it, right? To keep the pressure up. Because the only way you win against the mage is if he can't remove your board at all, right?
Oh yeah, pressure the Freeze Mage with your Shield Bearer, man.
Oh man, this is so sad.
Oh my god.
It might actually end up clogging your board.
Look at Tash. He's like, oh, Shield Bearer.
That seems like a good minion to leave on the board.
Oh man, look at him, he's laughing. Oh my god.
Legends speak of a cure for cancer discovered when all your board is filled up with 0 attack minions. Mm-hmm. Hence the Shield Bearer here,
now,
I think.
Now that is a very good draw, actually, you know.
On curve, yeah, the Doom... Fist of Draxxus stop deck is the best.
Exactly.
That would be the dream.
Well, that would be like 4 free damage. It's insane.
Will Thais ping the imp? Oh no, I was gonna say ping the imp to deny a Doomguard, but the acolyte can still be sacrificed into with the owl.
Yeah, exactly. So probably not. Cone of Cold is looking pretty good for Taish next turn. But I see. It feels like that. You just want to go face here. I mean, at the end of the day, acolyte's gonna draw 2 cards no matter what, right?
Yeah, in this situation, there's nothing that you can do to deny the 2 cards. I mean, I guess if you want to unclog your board, like if you think the mage is gonna lose the acolyte by the end of next turn, and you're gonna want to play Doomguard, maybe you sacrifice the owl to guarantee that you're gonna have room.
Nah, in the end, it's just like face damage is the most important. It doesn't really matter. Like you're overthinking, right? Freeze Mage. The only way for Zulok to beat a Freeze Mage is through damage.
And as fast as possible, right? Like you also have to push it as early as you can.
Yeah, you're not gonna beat AoEs. Back in super early beta where Blood Imp actually just increased health of all creatures by 1.
Oh my god.
Oh, I mean, maybe we have a chance there, but not anymore.
Alright, well, let's see if the Doomguard picks up a Flame... No, it's not a Fist of Draxxus. It's a Flame Imp instead.
Let's toss out the Flame Imp and play the Doomguard immediately. And,
Wish face. Unless you want to trade the 2/4 into the Acolyte to deny card draw. But again, that damage is so important.
Yeah, it's all really about damage. Because, like, your opponent already has, like, 7 cards next turn. Like, giving them to 8 and deny that 1 card with 9 doesn't seem that threatening, right?
It doesn't really matter too much. Like, that one extra card at this point is just kind of fluff. Yeah. But she's thinking about it.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't fault her for it. I think this is a fine move, even if she decides to trade. But, yeah. So, once again, we have no secret on Tasha's support, right? So.
Yeah, and he can't... You know what? This shield bearer is preventing him from sacrificing the mad scientist. and getting his secrets out. Oh, maybe man. That's the function of the card. It's like, too many people are playing mages with mad scientists. Let's just play shield bearer. And spend two turns doing nothing.
Yeah, it seems like this Kona Kota is going to do a lot of work, though. You Kona Kota first, and the in-game boss actually does not summon another creature. You know, actually, looking at this board, Doomsayer at 07 is actually really good. Because it's another body for Fist of Draxxus to miss on.
Yeah, and it's a lot of damage missed as well. Like, like 4 damage on a dead minion. It's kind of like when it tanks the Boombots, right? Like, you're super happy about it.
Mm-hmm.
This is exactly the same situation.
Whoa! Tesh feels threatened enough to play Blizzard, okay. Just clears off the board as much as he can. 2-1-1s come back alive.
And now he can sacrifice a mad scientist.
Oh, okay.
After all is said and done.
Makes sense. Soulfire is a lot of damage. Oh, I think this Soulfire is going in one direction. I wonder where.
Didn't they split up?
Wait, what?
You haven't heard? One Direction is splitting up.
Oh. I don't track that One Direction. I only know One Direction in terms of like...
Okay.
What's
that? You know what, Amaz? You haven't missed anything. It's kind of like...
Oh, that face?
You know, we have... Like in Canada, we have Justin Bieber, and One Direction is the pride of someone else.
Well, I'm Canadian, so I guess I should be ashamed of myself a little bit. But no, it's definitely not what I meant.
It's alright.
Alright.
Well, I guess One Direction is not getting soul fired. That's what I understood from this day.
Okay. Well, back to Tash here. I think he just needs to figure out a way that he doesn't die to the most top deck cards possible. Because this Kona Kota, while it's actually freezing the Doomguard, it's pretty good. It's also spotting two imps for Eloise. And, well, it's actually just preventing, say... One less
damage. Seven damage, right?
Well, yeah, 7 damage.
So, it's still a pretty good Kona Cold, since you've got the Flame Strike to follow it up with.
Yeah.
Now it's all about whether, yeah, you have to get that secret up, because the top decks would be way too dangerous.
Way too dangerous. Plus, Zulox usually come by, oh, wow!
The better one.
Okay, that makes sense, yeah. If it's Ice Bear, then it makes sense. We see another tech card from Eloise, the Flame Juggler.
Yeah, and I love that card just because so many people are playing, you know, a Hybrid Hunter in metagame. A lot of, like, Paladin decks are opening up with so many more recruits when you can get a Flame Juggler to deny one of them early with a ping. You know, as a mage player, you can play Flame Juggler in your deck. It's helping out quite a bit.
You think Flame Juggler would be a better card if it just target minions? And actually,
yeah, of course. It would be crazy good, actually, I think.
I'm not sure if it would be too good. I think it would be fine.
I think it'd be balanced. I think it's almost the tool everybody needs to deny that I feel icky guy.
Right, exactly.
Because like everybody needs a cool task, right?
Exactly. I wonder. I mean, compared to like an Iron Forge Rifleman, it's like infinite value. But Iron Forge Rifleman should really be like a 2-3, right?
Right. Yeah, that guy should have a bit more health, I think, to be playable.
All right. Wrathguard.
Pyroblast that thing, I say.
Alright. Now, Riven Egg is a pretty good draw. It's
not bad. Yep.
But, yeah, once again, Eloise is just looking to seal this game, right?
Yeah, this you just throw everything on the board.
Yeah, this this Doomsayer might actually help Taish out a little bit here.
I mean, if Fist of Draxxus ends up hitting that Doomsayer too, and this guy is MVP.
Mm-hmm. Alright. What do you have, Taish? Do we have an AoE? Ooh, Emperor. Oh, man.
Ice blocked, fireball, that flame guard, I guess. It's so awkward.
So, yeah, I think you should ice block, frostbolt, and then you can actually play Acolyte as well.
Oh, yeah, frostbolt. I didn't even see the card. Yeah, no, never mind. Never mind the fireball. What am I talking about?
Mm.
Why would you do that?
Whoa. What? No, it deals damage, right? Yeah, it deals damage.
I mean, it's 6 to the face, so I guess it kind of... Oh, this is great.
You were right, Noxious. Oh my god.
Never mind the ice block. Don't need anything of that. There's 1 damage on the board.
Alright. Well, Eloise can still win. There's a lot of
Doomguard's top deck.
Oh, that's 2 damage. And... Oh!
It's so close.
Wait, it's 1 damage off. Oh, no, it's not in yet. Oh,
no, it's not in there. It's not quite there. Oh, it's 1 off. No, no, it's 1 off. If that Flame Juggler had hit the face, it's the Doomslayer.
Oh, my God. That Doomslayer is MVP already, actually.
Oh, my God. This Doomslayer saved Thais. He doesn't know it yet.
Yeah, he does not.
He does not know it yet.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
Okay.
Emperor Ice Block.
Wow, how did Freeze Mage get into this position? Like,
I don't know. I have to assume Eloise's Zoo is pretty good at what it does.
Oh, okay. So what do we do here? We Arcane Inlet into a Frost Nova. That would be clutch. Is it?
I mean, there's a good chance he picks it up, right? Oh, man. Never mind. There's a good chance. So I guess you just go for Ice Block and play the Acolyte again.
Wait. You don't want to lose the Ice Block to just board.
Oh, this is so bad. But
so
yeah,
you want a Frostbolt, actually, just a 2-3, so that doesn't happen. You don't want...
So you Frostbolt to Ice Block?
Oh, man. Oh, we're drawing cards now. We want to fight Ice Lance, I guess. Oh! Frost Nova's pretty good.
He's down on the top deck, though.
Yeah, but... What? Like...
What, like, yeah, I think you're right. No, I think I absolutely understand your train of thought there. What does that do, really?
All right. Hello, well, keeping this soul fire is actually going to be paying off. Oh, whoops, that's a mistake.
That didn't quite hit the mark.
Okay, well, that was a tiny bit of a mistake there. Of course, Eloise is not going to tap. The only way she loses now is to, like, a top deck, you know. Burst or something. So Tash is looking for the Ice Lance. Ice Lance? Oh! Another chance?
More time. You can even play the Acolyte and ping it. Yeah. That's giving you even more time to find the lethal.
Actually, in Tash's perspective, if he Frost Novas, there's actually a chance that he doesn't get his block propped, right? Well, you know it's going to be like the worst case scenario, and you should actually ping the Acolyte instead.
So I guess you just Nova Acolyte? And hope that, because I mean, it's either that or you play the second Mad Scientist for the Ice Barrier, right?
Oh, Ice Barrier? That's not sugar, too. You can also play a. Ooh, we can play a Doom Series. I like this.
Man, well, Eloise is going to be forced to play that Soul Fire.
Man, this Soul Fire is going to be so good.
Oh, my God. That's such a bad time
for this. Combo! Wait a minute.
Such a bad time for it.
Alright, Soul Fire.
If it hits face after the Ice Block.
No, Oh, yeah, Fisk could hit the face, right? Yeah. Oh! This thing, the face does nothing there. Yeah. That's pretty funny.
She's gonna be stuck with an egg.
Yeah, we have an egg, but we have an ice barrier up. But hey, if Eloise plays 1 Soulfire, we know she probably plays 2.
She played 1 in the early game, I think. It went 1 direction.
Oh, wait, 1 direction. Hey, oh, wait.
The first one went 1 direction, and the second one just discarded.
So, oh, wow, so greedy. We're gonna tap here, okay. I like it.
She can still win, but it's gonna take.
And Thanos! One time lucky. The Hillum finally picks up a game.
Sometimes lucky. Thais gets the win.
Alright. Well, I mean, there are a lot of cards, to be honest, that Thais could have got, but yeah.
Hell, it's about time. I think it's about time that those guys get a win, right? Like, they played pretty well, and now they have a chance to maybe climb back. They're up against Gaara and Eloise. Now again, if Eloise goes out again, she can get benched. There's a chance that Nihilim is going to be able to take a lot of wins against the Priest. Mm-hmm. Maybe up until Life Coach is forced to bring out the slow Paladin, because that can't be a good matchup for them.
Right. It's actually quite crazy to think about, like, this whole situation, like, this whole 4-1 situation came about just because Taish lost that first
game.
Right. Oh.
It snowballed out of control after that point. And it's funny because if that match had been won, like, the advantage might have gone to them. And the odds were really in their favor, like, in that match. Like, all throughout the game, every top deck, we expected a lethal. And, I think 5 turns in a row, there was, like, a lethal waiting for Thais to be picked up. And as much as he stalled, it never came. So maybe Nihilum could get themselves a check mark on one of the players and then move on to maybe equalize the series 4-4, which would be pretty insane.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be like a crazy possible reverse sweep. Do you think Temple Storm is going to send out Eloise again with the same deck and risk the bench, or try their hand at Gaara?
Oh, man. If Eloise comes out again and Eloise does lose the match, then Gaara has to play Priest, like, maybe even 2 times, right? So that is a very big risk. So if I'm Nihilum, actually, right now, I would just if I can choose a deck that can counter both, then obviously really, really good. We're looking at obviously Patron being the counter, right? So maybe just run Patron anyways. But if you really want to target Priest, I think this is a good time to do it now. So I think Druid might be a very high risk, high reward play.
Yeah, a lot of people say that Priest isn't as bad as it used to be against Druid, because I remember initially when, you know, in the old school metagame, Priest was just horrendous. Like, you could never win.
Yeah.
But things have changed a bit. You know, Priest is now a little bit more consistent across most classes, and Druid is one of their lesser... I guess it's less weak than it used to be against them. But the thing is, Darnassus Aspirant buffing up Druid, does that make the matchup any more difficult for Priest?
I think it does, right? Okay. As a Priest, you only lose to Wildgrove. And not only that, it's because if you run Aspirants in your Druid deck, you actually run more card draw, right? Because your deck is kind of like fizzles out really, really quickly.
Right.
So
right.
You're playing against Azdrick, which is like a 4-4 and draws a card. We're playing against Ancient of the Lord, which is 5-5 and draws two cards, right? So I think it's just, it's pretty bad. And of course, you don't want to Cabal an Aspirant.
It feels a little awful, I think. You can't even play your Cabal for tempo if there's an Aspirant on the board, because you're forced to take it. Like, it's not an optional thing. It's not, hey, do you want to take a 2-drop? No, you're forced to.
Yeah.
So attack or less, that's yours.
Yeah, exactly. And now here's another bad matchup too, right? Warrior against Priest. It's like Warrior has like the most time to draw the combo against the Priest. Priest is just so slow, no pressure at all. Patron Warriors usually only lose to hyper aggressive decks, such as, you know, hybrid hunters have like not all one health minions, right? So their board is actually pretty good. They also lose to Patron is a very good deck. I'm trying to think of decks to beat it right now, but just very, very fast decks, I guess.
So it turns out, I mean, I've seen decks though, like Priest, actually able to beat Patron just because of tempo. Like, there are tempo plays that can be done with a Dragon Priest. Well, he's playing Dragon Priest.
Life Coach is not playing Patron. Oh yeah, that's right.
I know the Gaara can play, like, the new decks for Priest are very tempo heavy. And if, you know, you don't get your, you know, injured Blade Masters executed, if you get a good Dragon board at any point, it's pretty rough as a warrior to take care of that, I find.
Yeah, you're right. And I actually completely forgot that Life Coach is not playing Patron. So I think this might be a very good matchup for Gaara. You might get all the tools you need. Of course, Execute.
Double weapon.
Yeah, double weapon is really good. And yeah, no dragon so far in Gaara's hand. You'll be looking to find one. But Execute just makes this matchup so good, right? You just got to make that Execute land on Ysera. And I believe that Dragon Priests are not running Mind Control right now, because Mind Control is such a heavy card.
It's way too slow. Like, the metagame hasn't settled so far into the, like, heavy control. So that card very often just loses you the game.
Exactly.
If you play it against... if you draw it against some of the slower decks. The faster deck, that is.
Okay, so here, do you just play a 1-4?
Honestly, I hate doing that. I mean, you can heal your guy, but your Fiery War Axe will take care of the Wormwrist Agent. You're getting... if I'm going to play that 1-4, I'm going to play it next turn. But then I picked up the Dark Cultist, so why bother?
Mm-hmm. Well, Life Coach here doesn't seem like he has the best thing. Like, War Axe is okay. If you think about Priest, they don't have a 6 health creature at turn 3. Like, it's actually impossible. Well, actually, it's very possible in Gaara's...
You could, right, yeah, now, but it's...
With Powered Shield, but... Not a 3-drop, right? So I wouldn't mind equipping this War Axe just to, you know,
threaten,
make your opponent more awkward and actually cycle the shield block next turn. You are playing Control Warrior after all, and more stuff. But nope, Life Coach does the armor up. He is playing Shield Slam, so that's the thing. Oh, here's a dragon.
Alright, that's a great pickup for Gaara. Finally finds himself a dragon. What's awkward about Chilma is that Chilma is a dragon, but it needs a dragon to do what it does.
Right.
And I wouldn't be surprised if we saw tournament players forget that they don't have the dragon and rely on the 3 damage AoE.
The thing about Chilma is kind of cool because you can bluff your opponent too, right?
Right, right. Like, they don't know.
There's no dragon. But it's actually one of the weirder cards where if Chilma is a good card, why don't people play Abomination, right? It's kind of achieving the same thing. And I think the main problem is your opponent gets to decide when it dies. You don't decide when it gets. Dies because when you play it, you have to wait a turn and your opponent gets the choice.
I think the Iron Bical is the deal, because Abomination, when you negate the effect in the mid game, Iron Bikel is already more likely to be played mid-game than late-game. If you're playing Thresh, the need to be silenced. Like, Twilight Guardians are really problematic if you're playing against them non-stop. Minions that are buffed with Velen's Chosen eat up the silences. So it happens pretty often that Shell Maw will simply not have a silence against it, whereas A-Bomb, if it was played, probably would. Hmm. All right. Weapon play here for Life Coach. A pretty obvious play, I think. Was there another line of play that you would have considered?
You could save the coin and use the War Axe instead. But having the Desperate Establish does help out a lot against like 5-4 creatures. Hey, like that Dragonkin Sorcerer.
Oh man, I'm loving this. I'm loving this.
Yeah, Dragonkin Sorcerer is amazing here. I mean, next turn it's going to be like a 4-6. And yeah, then it's going to be buffed by 2 extra health, 4-8. Wait, it's pretty strong. So and this turn you just play something to throw to the Despite, right? So I would assume that Windrest Agent would be a good play here.
Yeah, you could force your opponent to use his weapon. I think that's a great idea. I mean, there's a chance that Life Coach plays it super passively
and just doesn't do it. Just doesn't use the Despite charge.
Yeah, I'm curious to know if he's gonna do anything like that. Because I mean, you could just smash, like, pass your turn and hope that your opponent ends up trying to train into Zombie Chow.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can maybe get that execute value on the next drop that comes after it.
Yeah, it seems like Gar is a little bit wondering if he wants to just use another move completely. Like, maybe just play Technician and Power Shield it. That could be a play.
Yeah, he definitely wants to eat up the axe, though. I think you're right. Like, he wants to throw something on the board so that Life Coach will feel like it's going to be good enough value with the Death Bite when it's not.
Mm-hmm. Brawl is pretty decent against the Dragon Priest, I would say.
Yeah, it's one of the key... I think in this matchup, it's funny how Control Warrior get absolutely wrecked with Varian Rin by Light Bomb.
Oh, wow. That's
and Brawl against Dragon Priest is also like the amazing counter. So those two classes have tools to counter each other's new archetypes in a way.
All right, I think I like the shield block here. You do want to cycle. It's a matchup where cards are actually very, very relevant, and fatigue doesn't really set in too much. I mean, like back then.
Back in the days.
Back in the old days where priests were running double mind control, you know, Ragnarok, Zera, stuff like that. You know, it's just so heavy, and those games tend to go to fatigue, right? But I think I love the cycle here. Life Coach is also running Bash, which is a very bad card against Priest, so you really need to dig deeper.
Alright, Gaara got the Death Bite out of the way, so he must be feeling pretty happy about playing the potential Dragonkin Sorcerer. But again, it's the same problem we ran into like in this situation, is if you use your buff, sure you're cycling it, but you're wasting the potential if there's an execute, because you basically feed him like Dragonkin Sorcerer, like one of your biggest... Again, Dragon is kind of your holy champion, mm-hmm. right? It's like your big mid-game threat. And if he's got the execute, then it feels a little awful.
Alright, that's pretty good. And Light Bomb does show in the hand. Now, this matchup is very, very exciting because it feels like both players have the necessary tools to win, and it seems like the better player will win, right? They both have AoE clears, they both have a lot of big minions to swing the board, and they both have very premium removal, right? So like Execute with Death, Light Bomb with Brawl, and then you've got Ezeras and Chill Maws everywhere. It's about to see who can actually pilot you know, the battlefield to be the best it's going to...
I wasn't going to be surprised if Life Coach just went for a Bash weapon to kill this instead. But he values the armor way over the equipping the weapon, and the board control is also relevant to him.
Yeah, seems like in the single removal department, Warriors have it a little bit better because they not only have Shield Slam, they have Execute. So four removals as opposed to two deaths from the Priest.
I think Bash is way underrated. I've seen too many people, well, yeah, no pun intended,
bash on it.
Yeah, I think that's true because I see the card and I'm like, oh, it's kind of like when people saw Dark Bomb. Like, a lot of players said, of course, you know, most pros acknowledged that card was bonkers for Warlocks, but a lot of people realized that, oh, it's objectively worse than Frostbolt. But the niche that it filled in the class that it belonged to was very much needed. And I think Bash is pretty much that for Warriors in a weird way.
Yeah, I think it's fine to have, like, cards that are, no matter what, better than other class cards. So, for example, like, even Fireball and Mortal Strike, right?
Yeah, on game release, right, we had that. So, it's not...
It's not, like, something new that's, oh my god, blowing your mind.
Yeah. Objectively better cards? You mean Druid of the Claw is better than Fen Creeper? No. It dies to Hemet.
That's true. There's always something. There's always something. Now, Chillmon's gonna come down Regara. Seems like a very good. The crowd is cheering on the top left there. Pretty cool. And once again, Chillmon does deal 3 damage across the board when it dies, and not only 2. So I guess Life Coach here is just looking to keep the Belcher alive and use everything else to clear it. But then he does lose all his armor.
Yeah, you can play another Belcher and armor up. So I think that buys you enough time to then armor up for multiple turns in a row after this. Because what's happening is he wants to make sure he gets Ysera out on 9, right? Like, that's the key. So what he's trying to do here is find a way to navigate to turn 9 in a comfortable position. And the best way to do that is probably to set up the Sludge Belcher. Maybe next turn. Like, you might play the Acolyte now if you're not afraid of Cabal because it's Dragon Priest. So it really depends on what he knows about the matchup. Because it's a very young deck. Is he just going to bash this?
No. Actually, bash is actually really good. I mean, after all that analysis of, like, you know, playing Ysera on that turn, just bash is pretty good.
Yeah, but this is, like, the reason this is such a good play from Life Coach is that on turn 8, he can play, even if the Belcher dies now, he gets another taunt before turn 9, which protects Ysera.
That's true.
From a potential bigger board.
Wow, bash is actually pretty good there, Masters. You might be right. It actually not only saved 6 health, it actually gained 3 health as well. So it's like a 9 health swing. So you basically pyroblast yourself for healing. Wow.
Well, yeah, you're healing touch, right?
Yeah, so 3 mana pyroblast yourself.
That sounds very good. Yeah, you know what? I think Handlock might play that. Get those Moltons out.
Oh, Handlock would definitely play that. It seems like Handlock doesn't have like a 3 drop, right?
Yeah.
It's always just like BGH, and that's pretty much
Pretty much it, yeah. I mean, that's why we've seen Demon Handlock try to attempt, you know, all the M-Gang boss inclusions and all. Mm-hmm. Earthling Farce here, but again, it feels very,
yeah,
a little less impactful than you'd like.
Gar's thinking where to, wait, what? I don't think Gar has anything else to play here, just like heal, I guess. I guess you can bluff like more plays.
You could just, I think you have to just go for the card draw. It's too good not to
take. Like double cleric and just draw a card?
Draw 2 cards? Yeah, I'd take it. Okay. In this position, I think I'd take it. I'm already somewhat ahead of the warrior on cards, like by a small margin. If I can just make sure that my card quality is at least as good as his, I think I can take the game.
Okay, well, this is not just strictly you draw 2 cards. The Acolyte Pain is going to draw a card for Life Coach now.
Great draw here.
Yep. So everybody gets cards.
Yeah, Life Coach really picking up a nice shield block here because it's going to weave itself in perfectly with the Belcher to set up for the Ysera.
Right. Can we have a card count for these guys? I mean, we're looking at possibly a fatigue match too. So 15 right now for Gaara and
15 for.
So it's pretty close. It's like around the midway point.
No player has a massive edge just yet.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Ysera will fall to Vol'jin. Well, not quite fall, but that's a lot of health on a Vol'jin.
Yeah, exactly. And like we said, Life Coach already using Execute, but then Shield Slams could take care of it. Man, this match is just so cool. Everybody is given all the options. You can just play around stuff. It's actually the small minions, like the Belcher, the Blackwing Technician, that's actually the most problematic, right? Because they're not premium enough to have removal on it, and they actually do a lot of minion trading.
I must consider.
Yeah, tough turn here. I guess you can, one option is just to play your 2 rightmost cards, so Technician and the Twilight Guardian, and then just use the hero part. That's 9.
Yeah, that's a bit of an awkward thing with the Twilight Whelp, is in the mid game, you know, if you don't find it early game to make a zombie chow, it's still an enabler for everything else for the rest of the game. So it stays there as a, like, you'll never play it, almost.
Exactly.
Later in the game.
Yeah, it's actually a very good, good point there, because when I first looked at Twilight 12, I was like, why would I want to play a worse zombie child? But I guess just because like more dragons were introduced and also Rimmer's Agent was introduced,
right? Priest, of course.
Then this actually happens quite a bit where Twilight 12 is just good in your hand. It's just like a battery card.
All right. Well, I'd be surprised if we don't see any Ysera fallout now, but maybe Life Coach has other plans.
Well, you just drew the Taskmaster. It seems like there's a lot of value in Taskmaster and your Acolyte. and drawing lots of cards. It also kills the Twilight Guardian, which is a big plus.
Yeah, you can even kill that that leftmost technician.
Yeah, you can.
So yeah, this is a good. So no Ysera from Life Coach would still make sense. And again, if you're playing into Mind Control with Ysera, you're really losing the game. With that Brawl, nothing really scares you. It's just that if you give them your Ysera, you fed them a threat that you've had to answer yourself. Right, and then you then have to deal with their threats on their terms, and that feels a little awful.
Mm-hmm.
The armor gain.
Armor gain is pretty sick. All right, here's another card. Oh, Venre!
Light bomb for the win! I believe in the light bomb.
Okay. We'll have to see. Yeah, light bomb is just so frustrating against Venre. It's like mill three cards from your opponent, right?
Yeah, which is why I've had reservations about Varian. I don't know why. I think the card, if Light Bomb becomes like a staple, and Priest becomes everywhere, maybe Varian is just unplayable. Just
everywhere. That's pretty funny there. Noxious.
You don't believe in it. Even Imaz doesn't believe in it. That's pretty sad. I think we've gotten to a point in Hearthstone where we need to reconsider our lives.
Well, is it everywhere, right? Everywhere is like Hunters. That's everywhere.
But Priest might become everywhere. Maybe somebody will figure it out, right?
Okay, maybe. Someday.
Yeah, yeah. I'm hoping. Yeah. The dream is real.
Yeah. All right, so Gar here drew Ysera. Seems pretty bad, but it's actually pretty good. Because, like, in this board, you're looking at so many small creatures. Execute and Shield Slam is probably in Life Coach's hand. Ysera's only going to get you one card. And in this matchup, you really want, like, two activations and stuff like that. So, but then do you really have any other move if you don't do that?
I mean, you could wait and just light bomb, but this board doesn't die to light bomb. So you're looking for, I mean, Ysera awakens almost every time. You could go for Nightmare and Shadow or Death as well. It's a combination that could get you out of trouble if something comes up. But my question is, if Life Coach...
They're just going for it.
I mean, it keeps the whelp to enable more dragons later on.
Yeah, it's actually pretty problematic for Life Coach. He doesn't have an answer for this.
Well, let's see if he picks it up.
Yeah, we'll see.
It's very likely, I think. Nope, not yet.
Oh, wow. That's quite unfortunate.
Counter Ysera? Just play yours?
That never feels good.
So you just don't want to see the mind control hit, right? Like, it's even worse now because you're going to give him even more activations.
Yeah, I don't think mind control will be in this deck, but Sylvanas Death certainly is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Well, seems like that's the play.
I can't see anything else. I mean, Varian Rin, what is it weak to? Like, you know it's weak to Light Bomb, of course. Like, that's pretty much a given.
Yeah. But Varian Rin also drops Life Coach down another three cards. So, like, Fatigue is always, like, a question here now at this point. Ooh!
Alright, Life Coach decides this Ysera is too valuable for my opponent. I can't let it sit there. If it wins the ball! Oh my god.
Wow!
Down goes Venruki.
No. Alright. Lost the game.
Yeah, that's really painful.
It's like, no. Look at cards, have it there. Oh man.
This is what we call getting annihilated. I don't know Life Coach is going to recover from this.
Why did Life Coach brawl after trading? Like, if you really want to kill off the Ysera, you should brawl before you trade.
The armor, maybe? I don't see the point of it, really.
He changed his mind in the middle. There's no way you cast brawl
after the
trade.
It's the my team is losing factor kicking in. And now I think if he top decks ice, like a Shield Slam, sorry, he's still in a good shape, because he gets to play his own Ysera, and he's usually going to be fine.
Oh, but another Ysera card you dropped. Oh, man.
Yeah.
That coach is physically very stressed out.
Shield Slam allows him to swing back the game considerably, though.
But it's like another one card here.
Ugh, another whiff.
Yes, it won't be.
Shield Maiden BGH. That is so weak. It's a BGH on a target that doesn't even belong in that deck. Like, it's not even in. It's not even a card you're teching against your opponent. You're teching it against things that just aren't even taking slots.
So you're BGHing air, basically. That seems pretty terrible. Well, Varian has to come down here. Let's see what the Armies of Stormwind bring. Oh.
Well, that's a card, I guess. Pretty useful, except it's a little late to find it.
Oh man, nothing's working out.
So I guess you just go for that Volgen right now, right? And then you Shadow or Death it.
No, not exactly, right?
Nah, you just Shadow or Death. You don't want the health.
No. Volgen is premium removal. You just want to throw it away.
So do you expect Ysera in every Control Warrior nowadays?
Control Warrior?
It was cut for a lot of them.
Well, I mean, Life Coach did show us Ysera yesterday, so
I
would definitely expect that.
Great point. It's basically, as you said, premium removal against it.
Yeah, I guess Shield Slam and the Deathbite Slam does... The attack does kill the Ysera now, but... Man, 3 Ysera cards already. Yeah, of course.
A little late. All the good removal is at the bottom of the deck. Can Life Coach still pile this to a win?
Yeah, I mean, right now you can actually Shield Slam the Drake, attack the Laughing Sister, re-equip the weapon, and then use Execute.
Well, I mean, you can kill Ysera with a Shield Slam with Shield Maiden, right?
Oh, yeah, so. That's true. Yeah, that's really better. You want to... I mean, if you're saving the ass that long, you might as well just keep on saving it. Oh, man.
So, I mean, Ysera drew 3 cards, which might be instrumental, of course, in Gaara winning this.
No, I think the main reason why Gaara is winning this, by far, is the card count. Life Coach is down to, how many cards? Like, 5 cards?
6. Yeah, he's got 6 left. Yeah, 6 cards. Gaara is painful.
Double the amount of cards. Alright, one way for Life Coach to win is that Ysera sticks on the board for a long time. That's really the only thing that can help. Seems like he's gonna use his double armors, double Shield Slam.
Is he gonna keep his second Shield Slam for something else?
Whoa!
He's greedy about it. I have to question this, but maybe he thinks the 7-6 will attack into the Shield Maiden often enough that's worth it.
Yep. Gaara's doing a pretty good job here. He identifies that this matchup is now down to a fatigue war. Right, as long as he removes all of Life Coach's threats, that's it. That's the game.
Yeah, and he's also posing a really big problem with those cards. Harrison Jones is useless in the matchup. It's a big body, but again, nothing that's going to swing the game in your favor. Unless it comes down to like a 1v1, both in fatigue, last minion standing is Harrison Jones. Life Coach gets good Shield Slam value, at least takes away a minion and his Valence Chosen. Gets a BGH. I mean, that's not too bad. I think Life Coach, as far as the board goes, if he gets ahead on it, from his perspective, he can still win it.
Okay, I don't think so. The Volgen and Smite is just so good against Ysera.
From his perspective, of course.
Yeah, from his perspective. Actually, from his perspective, it's pretty bad too. The opponent's holding 7 cards and you're holding 3.
What does Life Coach even... he's got a Ragnaros in his deck left?
Mm-hmm.
Or does he not play it? There's a Dr. Boom, I'm guessing. I'd be surprised if there wasn't.
Yeah, Dr. Boom is one of those cards where you kind of want to have. So, yeah. Well, all the options available for Gaara.
Yeah, he's got almost too many of them. I mean, there's nothing on the board that's going to stick there if he doesn't want it to. And the only way Gaara loses this is if he's overzealous about wasting his removal.
Yeah.
I mean, you could Light Bomb here, probably. You've seen Varian Wrynn. That's kind of your Light Bomb target. Ysera comes out, you've got Volgen Smite. A big threat like Grom comes out, you've got Shadow of Death.
Actually, yeah, there's only 2 more threats that Life Coach hasn't drawn yet, right? It's the Dr. Boom and the Grom.
Maybe he's just gonna Nova here because it's so. This is the only value you'll ever get out of it. And it acts as a Light Bomb. You don't really care for that 3/5 since there's gonna be a Fatigue War.
Yeah, it makes sense. And Light Bomb is one of your premium removals. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That doesn't make sense. I
dream. Nope. Right. Not gonna play that ever, thinks Life Coach.
What is Azushra gonna draw? Nightmare.
That's some Grom Burst, but she's gonna have to draw a bit more than that, and it's not gonna happen.
Yep, that's just gonna get wrecked.
A 6/12.
Casual 6/12.
I was just casually buffing my minion to 12 health, thank you.
I think Laughing Sister might have been the best card there. Because it doesn't get removed by anything and it's 3 repetitive damage. Oh, just gonna buff that up, okay.
Picks up a dragon.
Not bad. You kinda can't play that just yet, so...
Yeah. Yeah. Take your time, I guess. I mean, there's no hurry at this point. Life Coach can just take a sweet time. I mean, Gaara can take a sweet time, because... I mean, he even put on sunglasses. I think that's a great sign, right?
Yeah.
Like, he casually put on sunglasses sometime in the last... I don't know, this match has gone, what, 35 minutes? Priest versus Warrior? So, in the last 35 minutes.
I don't like that Acolyte. I think Gaara can actually just play Light Bomb here.
Oh, man. Light Bomb to make him draw.
Yeah.
Welcome to hell. That might be worth the Light Bomb. Life Coach just looks like a man who lost his entire family to a tsunami and is forced to play the card game.
I don't know. It just feels like the Acolyte was definitely not right there. It also means that Life Coach can't actually use the axe now, because the Acolyte was too much.
Gaara is basically never going to lose anything to this axe.
I don't know. Is there a way that Life Coach can still win if he runs Alexstrasza? I can win if he runs Alexstrasza.
Well, yeah, because Alexstrasza into Grom with Nightmare is enough to push his opponent out of the game. But
I think he cut it. I don't think he has it.
You think he plays what instead, Ysera?
Yeah, Ysera instead. If Ysera, Varian, and Dr. Broom, and we have like what Emperor, Sylvanas hasn't been seen yet. Just how many bombs do you need? Oh, it's two more cards.
But honestly, if he reduces the cost of both of them,
no, that's it. It's Grommash,
and
Dr. Broom.
So he wants to draw the Grommash right now and then follow it up with Dr. Broom. Whoa! There's no Grom.
There's no Grom.
There's no Grom.
There's no Grom.
There's no Grom. Actually, he might still win, right? Because look
there
at those
is
threats.
A chance.
Yeah.
Like, so small. No.
Alright, so Black Moon Corruptor on that thing, and then Shadow of Death, the Dr. Boom. Just hit the Acolyte once more, right? The last one for the road.
Oh man, I don't think you care anymore. You just need to like remove all the threats. Yeah, your opponent's fatigue is gonna raise yours just way more. So I think I'll be perfectly fine with death here.
Shadow or death and just play a whelp.
You don't even need to play anything, to be honest.
Just one whelp.
I mean, sure.
Okay, maybe you can play it after. I mean, it doesn't really matter.
It doesn't really matter.
In the end.
Oh man, I feel a little bit bad now. Look at Life Coach. He's just...
Yeah, he's a dead man walking. That's definitely what's going on. He's got this look about him.
Oh. Gar's like tormenting Life Coach at this point. Okay. Now. It's time to get a lot of value.
Yeah, 8 damage on those Boombas, right?
You want to kill the Drake. You want to just... One Boomba kills the Drake, and then you play, like, something else. Whoa. What's happening?
Is this how you win? I mean, there's still a chance, because right now, Gaara can't kill those big threats from the opponent.
Yeah.
6 damage.
Okay, that's not bad. But I really disagree on, like, using the Despite like that. No Despite is your removal.
Life coach. When the lights go up on his webcam, it's even better. Oh yeah, no, definitely.
All right. Well, this is something.
4 cards left.
You know, Nightmare on the Sylvanas might be a good play. Like it might be fine. Just Nightmare and pass.
Huh? Yeah.
I was thinking about it, cause like, the only way you can lose is to lose the damage.
I mean, Grom plus Cruel Task would kill you. But if he's been tracking cards, he knows that's not there at all.
Grommash isn't even the same.
Yeah. Costs, he's just a contest 1-1. Mm-hmm. No reason not to, really. You know your opponent's just gonna push damage. And if he does, then you just Holy Nova, maybe. You're gonna make the trade yourself.
Yeah, Thoris just ends the game. Like, Gaara just kills the Thoris Center with 5-4. Holy Nova's.
And Holy Nova's, that's
more,
it.
Just no more thing, yeah. No Grommash. Wow.
Is Life Coach actually thinking this turn true? Like, does he think there's a chance?
No, there's just no way, right?
Okay, you think he's pondering the meaning of life right now, then? Because he seems like he's caught up in some deep thinking right here.
It's like the RDU thing again, where it's not working out. I mean, this is your only move, so go ahead. And then Gar's just gonna give him the bad news.
Alright, that's a good play though from Life
Coach.
That
is a good play.
He does pick up on the fact that his opponent is going to Holy Nova. Mm-hmm. And now he wants to bluff the threat.
But there's no more.
But he got one chance.
Mm-hmm. So Gar here. Well.
Welp.
You have all the options in the world. I mean, come on.
Yeah, but play a Welp, buff a Welp.
That's good enough.
Put your opponent's Emperor Thorsten, if he wants to remove it, on one health, the Nova, and then wait. A victory by attrition.
A victory by attrition is a victory. Well, it seems like Gar just wants to torment Life Coach a little bit more.
I wonder.
I think he's doing all he can to not break up in laughter. I feel like this is a cosplay of some sort, but I can't quite pinpoint whose it is. Life Coach. Pushing for the face with a 5-5. He hopes he can get two rounds of damage in, but he knows he's not going to win this fatigue race because he's already way behind and going to die in like a few turns. If his opponent decides to push. Gaara has all the deck list of his opponent now. Not that it matters, but Life Coach is going to leave this. Doesn't want the extra information. Knows that his opponent could just wait it out if he wanted and not give it away.
That was a tough match.
Nihilim down in the dumpster. 5-1 for Temple Storm. Eloise has one deck left, that Wrathguard Zoo that we saw earlier. If that proves to be her weakness, then maybe the entire lineup from Nihilim could counter it. And I'd venture to say it's not impossible, because it's the type of deck that can definitely be so inconsistent because of the fact that it's somewhat novel and untested, unrefined, right? Like, it's got elements that aren't exactly refined. And if it turns out that it's so weak that Nihilim can reverse sweep it, then that's going to be history for Nihilim. Like, this team league, I will remember forever just because of that crazy roller coaster ride for them.
Yeah. Well, I mean, let's do a little good news first. If Nihilim actually loses this match, they're not out of the league yet. They go to the final Friday bracket, but they just want to get the win right now, right? And like you said, Eloise's Zulok could have a chance to just drop all the games. I mean, I feel more comfortable facing against Zulok 5 times than facing against Freeze Mage 5 times.
Right. The matchup is less polarized.
Exactly.
Like, you have less chance to just lose a 90%, 10%, right, in a specific matchup. Yeah. So it's going to be it's a more well-rounded deck. So as a result of that, your matchups tend to hover, you know, in the 65-35 range at worst. So you still stand a chance no matter what you're playing up against it very often. So we'll see exactly if Nihilim can take it. I don't know if they have tools to defeat it, because the Mech Shaman from RDU is, I want to say, like, kind of a weak point. But if you can Lava Burst or Wrathguard, maybe it's like a, you're kind of happy about it.
Yeah, you're fulfilling two things at once. You're going face and clearing the board. That's
something you do very often against Zoo. You have to choose, like, and the Wrathguard gives you the opportunity to do both.
Yeah. Seems like the hardest matchups for Nihilim against the Zoo deck is going to be the Druid. The Paladin is going to be quite hard. And Control Warrior is actually going to be a little bit hard too, where you actually need the start. Otherwise, your opponent just runs the board. And we know that Eloise is running a little bit more heavy creatures, right? We have the Wrathguard. A Flame into Wrathguard is 7 power on the board at turn 2. And that's a lot. That requires immediate removal. So, just going to wait a little bit longer for Nihilim to pick their deck.
Yeah, I think they also need to recover from the mental exhaustion that comes from taking 5 losses this way in this event. When they're so close to maybe just getting to the finals directly after all the things they had to do to get back in a position where they could.
Wow, right, I can't believe Life Coach is queuing again. That's something, definitely.
Yeah, maybe he needs it. Maybe he needs it for his sanity to stay sane.
Alright, and it's not even that good a matchup, right?
It's alright if you can shield slam a Radgar for 32.
Yeah. I guess Bash helps, but
it's pretty sweet.
Okay, I guess Eloise is playing the Shield Bear as well, so that's the thing. Shield Bear is actually good against Warrior, right?
You have two weapon hits. It was actually one of the things that I think made it like one of the better minions in Zoo in the first iteration of Zoo, or the first few iterations of Zoo. It protected everything, and Warrior played Fire War Axes. All the other decks, like Zoo Mirror matches, were also improved by it because they would waste two attacks with a three attack minion into your Shield Bearer. Mm-hmm. Speaking of Bearer, this Lance Carrier is pretty sweet.
This Lance Carrier is gonna actually buff the Flame Imp next turn and kind of get the give Winfrey the Flame Imp, right? Because Life Coach has to remove it twice, which is pretty sweet.
Man, 10 damage taken from a one drop. That sounds about balanced.
Yeah.
But then again, all she's gonna be left with is a 1-2 after this, right? So we have to just put that into perspective. Sure, she's gaining a huge burst right off the bat, but it's going to fade away very soon. Like, the advantage of it.
Actually, it would be a pretty smart play to play Wolf here instead. Because it lines up perfectly, right? If Life Ghost plays a life, Armor Sphere, and then you Lance Carry the Wolf, it can actually kill it.
Great call. He's gonna, I mean, Eloise just sees that, and Life Coach is probably gonna go for that play.
Well, Bashi would be perfect, but no, not quite. And down goes the Wolf, I guess.
Life Coach, though, is getting a Death Bite next turn into double. I want to point it out, like, there's a double Shield Maiden, so he's not quite out of it. Those are pretty big tempo plays. Life Coach will probably consider letting the AoE deal with this. Oh!
No, you just play.
You still have to go Death Bite, yeah.
You actually Death Bite the one. Oh my god.
But what about the Fin of Argus? Boss, what about Defender?
Man.
You don't believe in the Defender?
Eloise actually has so much burst in her hand. You have the Soul Fire to Fist.
I wonder. No. It hurts me to see that much burst in a Zoo hand. It's crazy good.
This is pretty over.
Like, it's crazy to think that the Lance Carrier is giving Gazoo another abusive sergeant, but better. When they get the initiative on the board, they can maintain it even further. Just like they're pushing face hunter like damage very early because of that Lance Carrier.
Right. And of course, the dream for Lance Carrier is that the minion does survive, so the buff stays around.
Yeah, exactly. So you're getting so much value out of it. Up against weapon classes, it's pretty insane.
Life Coach really needs to hit this flame in. It doesn't look good, but you have to do it. You have to hit this Flame Imp.
Although, I guess if you play Belcher, you can probably tank the Flame Imp with it and then play Shield Maiden and keep your weapon.
Yeah, just wait for Soul Fire and Fist to happen.
Well, it'll still run to the Slime, right?
Yeah.
So if you think about it, this play from Life Coach is still pretty okay.
Oh, man. Absolutely.
Take that.
6 damage.
Bash.
No bash.
Oh my goodness, that's a lot of damage.
We have to do it, there's no other choice.
But this is where he stabilizes, I think. Unless
yeah, Eloise needs a 3-drop. 3-drop would be perfect here. Oh, that's really good too.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine.
If it juggles, that will be insane.
Mm-hmm. If it juggles, I'm going to cry for Life Coach tonight.
Okay.
A 6-1, wait, is that the worst that's ever happened? I've seen 6-2.
6-1 is... Yeah, it's the worst. There's no 6-0s, so obviously 6-1 is the worst.
Wow! Nice job, juggler. You shall not pass. So how does this work? Does Death Rattle trigger before discard? I'd imagine
not. No, fist first.
Okay. So Shield Maiden comes down. It'll weather what damage is already on the board, but if she picks up...
Okay, that's something that's a little bit of hope. So basically, Life Coach needs to stall until he gets a Brawl.
Or Bash. I mean, Bash is such a crazy swing card.
Bash is really good in this matchup, yes. That's true.
Let's see what she picks up. It's the Doom Guard. Somebody's going to cry. No, it's not. And...
Oh.
Wow.
Actually, Argus here is not that good. Because, like, Shield Bear is...
you're right. You're supposed to protect your things. Exactly. But then Defender does the opposite. Oh. You know what I find funny about that guy is that he actually doesn't protect anyone, right? Like, his shield is hidden behind friendly lines. It actually doesn't defend anybody. He gives people shields. I vote that we change the battle cry of the guy to defend me, because he really does nothing. So Imgang boss is probably the better play. I mean, if you're looking for raw damage, maybe you play defender.
Raw damage, yes, definitely. But judging by this board position, it seems like Imgang boss might be a bit better.
Yeah.
Not really sure, because like you're kind of running out of time, right?
Yeah, 75 seconds in a turn.
Alright, let's go for that. The best card for Life Coach would probably be either Bash or Deathbite. Deathbite actually removes this Shield Bearer. No, not that.
Not the best of cards, but after another Shield Maiden, I think you're going to feel a little safer, because now you can start using those 5/5s as trading tools, right?
Oh, actually, I think you're using the War Axe here, just to remove the board.
So, Shield Block, War Axe, Armor Up. Actually, yeah, you're right. That's going to give you a much better curve, and you get 7 armor instead of just the 5.
And I think you actually Shield Block first.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you find a Bash, you play that one instead.
I really like Bash. I just love that card so much. I don't know why. Like, this card just seems super well designed. All right, let's see if...
Yeah, Shield Block first.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Armor is negligible, I think, right now. Your opponent is always going to remove all your armor.
If you pick up a Shield Slam, would you use that instead of the armor?
Yes. You just...
Of course.
Yeah, they remove everything. So if you pick up a Shield Slam, you actually remove the Imgang boss. Well, kind of. But... Oh, no.
I mean, if he armors up, he's going to be on 13 health, right? So Doomguard wouldn't kill him just yet.
Okay, let's see here.
He doesn't Shield Block first, Shield Blocks afterwards. Life Coach is...
The rope is running out! The rope is running out!
Oh!
Shield Slam!
Yep. He got it, he got it off, alright.
Yeah. Oh man.
He didn't remove that much damage from the board. Actually, he removed one, and didn't really get the extra 2 armor he could've gotten.
Ooh.
Nice pickup by Eloise, perfectly on curve, mix of raw damage.
But this game is still up for grabs. Even though it's looking really bad for Life Coach, he still has one more Shield Maiden. Oh, no, not the card we want to see.
Yeah, he's looking for his removal pieces right now. That and anything that will give him health.
Anything that stalls the game. You even hit the Shield Maiden. Or do you actually trade the Shield Maiden against... Oh, man, this is tough.
You have to do it, like, I think you have to do it against a 2-2 to play for value.
Oh, man, you're playing for value now. Your health is dwindling down.
Doomguard is not lethal yet.
Oh!
One off lethal.
Oh man.
One off lethal. If Eloise picks up that soul fire.
Any of those would do it. Oh! That's also really good, actually. That's awesome.
Can Life Coach do this? Brawl? Not even Brawl doesn't do it because he's still dead.
So we need Varian Rin into double Belcher, right?
Varian Rin can't be played on 9, so.
Oh, whoops.
Belcher number 2, I guess.
Belcher is one way to do it, I guess. Yeah.
Belcher number 2 is actually all that saves him. I think. Wait, Alexstrasza?
No, he's not Alexstrasza.
He doesn't play Alex, that's right. Ysera's gonna be the top deck, right?
No, that's it.
Oh,
Tempo Storm, it's going through to the finale, and Nihilim drops short once again, and is going to try again in Friday's match. But yeah. Congratulations, Temple Storm. You're gonna make
crazy series. That was the most crushing victory I think I've seen from any of the matches that I've ever seen in Archon Team League so far. This is
absolutely soul crushing.
Yeah. Well, that's a bit unfortunate for Nihilim. Hopefully, they get a better lineup. You know, tomorrow. So we're gonna be seeing Team Archon versus Force and Boys after this, if I'm not mistaken, which will determine who gets to play the deciding match, right? Just to get to the finale.
Yeah. Not only does that determine the deciding match, it also determines who exits the Archon Team League early. Well, not early. They'll come out at 6th place. I mean, it's not a bad standing, but of course, you wish to go a little bit further than that, right?
Yeah, you want to get to that top 3. Not even the top 4. You want to get to that top 3 because that's where the prizes are. For the, you know, for the fame purpose, I guess you could go top 4 and say, I was really close to the prize pool, but ultimately you're looking to get that podium placement in the tournament. All right, well, I guess we'll be taking a short break, guys, and then we'll be back with Force and Boars versus Team Archon. That was a really good match. I'm pretty happy to have seen it.
Yep.
So, yeah, we'll be back after the break, guys. Don't go anywhere.